use it. So this is advantage of R. So just to lure you a little bit, why you need to learn that. So get R. So if for those who have not installed R, this is the link. You can go to the link and choose whatever operating system. If you use Windows, Mac, or Linux. So I assume everyone installed, right? Okay, I will. So you also need to get RStudio. So what's the difference between R and RStudio? You can see R is a compiler. It's a work behind your computer that change whatever you write into machine language the computer will understand. RStudio is an editor interface. So here another terminology people use, integrated development environment, IDE.
Recording.
Oh.
Just quit when you say that.
Okay, thank you.
So RStudio will be the editor interface, so it will be more user friendly rather than you. So you just like, this is the place where you type code and easy for to visualize your code. So some features about RStudio. So there is a syntax highlighting. So for example, like if you want to write a for loop, then the for will be highlighted into a different color, so you will not like squeeze your eyes to see it clearly. So some of the keywords will be highlighted in different color, easier for you to refer. It is code auto-completion. That means RStudio is very smart enough. If you want to write, for example, for loop, and I use for loop. So if you want to use for loop, you just write the for. It will auto-complete the bracket for you. So you don't have to type the bracket yourself. So it's very smart in that sense. Smart indentation, that means, for example, people want to write loops are in different lines, so when you press enter, it will automatically give you some indentation. So it's all for easy references later. And you can also execute the code directly from the editor interface, which is RStudio. So you can just press run, it will run line by line. So you can choose a line by line, or you can choose a block of codes and run them together. Data viewer is whenever you input some data into R, you can go to the data viewer, you can view the structure of the data. So it's for you to see the data, what you write is what you see that in that kind, in that sense. And R help. So whenever you do not know some function there, how you write some function and the function, what are the arguments you need, you can just write function name with a question mark. If the R will tell you what are the what's the argument inside this function. So this is the RStudio. That's why normally people just download R, but I recommend you download RStudio as well. So that's the background. Now let's go to the real cost. R language. So in the R language today, what I'm going to teach is some basic syntax. So that means what are the grammar rules in R. And data type. So that means for whatever language you use, you have to make sure the data you bring in into the you bring in into the software are supported. So I will introduce you the data type R support and also a data structure. What are structure of the data? So the data can be a columns, the data can be a matrix, the data can be a data frame. So this I will highlight all this later. And arithmetic operators. So how do you use R? You can use R as a calculator. Arithmetic is just a plus, minus, multiplication, division, all these things. So there are rules for this in R. And the logical operator that, for example, truth or false, equal or not. So these are logical operators. So I will teach them one by one. So let's go to the basic syntax. So now you may on your R Studio, which look like this. All on. You may not have this place. You may not have whatever I have here. It looks like this. Should be. Right? Okay. Everyone on. Right. So let's do a. So I will introduce the place. This region. It's called a console. You can see from the word. It's called a console here. So the console will be the place where you execute your code. And this place, the empty place, will be the editor place. So you write your R code here. And this region will be the global environment. Normally, it will store the variables you just input. It will have the overview of all your data, so which is the data view I just mentioned. This place has multiple use. It can show you whatever packages you already pre-installed. Oops. Or the plots, because so far we have not plot anything, so it will be empty. Okay, so let's do some basic codes. For example, okay. You go to your editor, you press this button, which is the plus. You can see at the top left corner, there is the R script. You press this, it will generate a place for you to write. Can you see? It will be untitled. No, this is R. You need to open R Studio. This is R. Yeah, have you installed R Studio? This is R. R itself has editor interface, but it's not user friendly. This is R. You need to install R Studio. This one, yeah, open it. Press. It should give you a.
Yeah, I think one is R and one is.
No. R Studio looks like this. This is R icon. This is R Studio icon. Yeah, so I need to. So Xiaodong is my friend, so he's also a pro in R. So he may just go around and see if everyone.
And if you have like problem opening the R Studio.
Yeah.
I also can help because yeah. I use R Studio.
Yeah, so everyone make sure you have this interface. Yeah, correct.
Yeah.
I just use a different background. If you want to change the background, you can go to the. Yeah, black one looks nicer, right? So you go to the, in R, for example.
Okay.
In R, you go to tools.
Mm-hmm.
I think, let me see. Global option.
Mm-hmm.
Appearance.
Okay, change it to black.
So if you want to change it into different color for your R, because mine is black, so it's easier to see. White one is very hard to see, right? So you can go to the top. So you can go to the tools, global appearance, go to the top layers. Here, tools, global appearance, a global option, appearance, and then you change your color. Here, tools, global option, then appearance. Here. Then you can change whatever color you want. You can press anyone, then choose the one you are comfortable with. Okay, everyone got it, this interface already, right? Yes, this is the correct one. Okay, let's do our basic stuff. We do very basic thing. For example, you can press 2. You can use R as a calculator if you want. 2 times bracket 5, 4 plus 2. So what will be the answer? Right, so you already write this line of commands, right? How to run it? How to tell R to run it? You can just choose this line, then press around here. Ta-da, 12. Okay, another way of running it is, you can choose it, then press, if you are using Mac, you can press Command plus return. If you will be doing the same thing. If you do not want to press the Run button, you can choose it, press Command, and return. If you're using Windows, you can just press Control, Enter, or return, if I'm not wrong. Right. Okay. So you can see from here. If you return you, you can see here is a 1. So you don't bother what this 1 means. It just means this is the first line of it. So 12 means a number, right? So this is very basic. You can use R as calculator. All right. Then variable name, this is very important in R, because normally if you want to just calculate basic arithmetics, you can use a calculator. You do not need to own your R. So what R can do is it can assign values into a variable. So first thing first, what is a variable in any programming language? If you have any previously encountered what is a Python, what is a C language, you will know this is about the same. So variable name is just a name you any variable is just a name that you assign a value to it. Then the name has some rules for it. So the name must not contain symbols other than underscore and a dot. So you have to make sure this is the first thing you when you design a variable name. It must not begin with a number. And also it's very case sensitive. So for example, value. If you want to install some value into a value variable, value is different from value. So you see the V is capital. It's capitalized, so it's case sensitive. And assign value in R language, you can assign values by a equal sign, or you can assign value by a arrow, but the arrow point to the variable name. For example here, the value here, you want to assign 23 into the small value. So the next time when you want to call this 23, you do not have to write 23. You write value, the value will return you a 23. So that means you assign value to a name. Is it easy to understand? Another thing is that you assign 45 to your value, the big value. So the next time when you write big value, it will return 45. And ls bracket, what is this? This is a list. So that means this function will list whatever values you installed in your computer. So later I will show you. And rm, what's rm? Rm comes from the remove. So when you don't want any value, you just remove, it will clear the RAM. And this value is no longer stored in your computer. So let's try it.
That's a question.
Hey. Bracket one. You mean this one? Yeah. Is it? I just mentioned it's a first number. I mean, because any value stored in R normally is stored in a vector. So that means this is a first element in this vector. But you don't have to bother this. This is just for R to memorize the location. Okay, you just look at here, 12. Okay, so let's try to assign value. For example, you can write value. You can either write this way with an arrow point towards value. For example, you gave a 23. Then another line, you can write big value. You can write 45. Okay, so this is the same thing if you write this, equal sign. Okay, equal sign and the arrow pointing toward the variable, they do the same. So my preference is to use equal sign because you have to press 2 buttons for the arrow, right? So let's write both. Okay, you already write this 2 lines. What? This one cannot change the color. This is a little bit problem with the screen.
Your font, can you change your
white. Oh, okay. It's very dark, right? Okay, I change it to white. Because when I do the programming, I prefer it's black. Okay.
What is the
two values? What's the
difference between the two values? The one with R. Okay. What?
Sorry?
What's the difference between these two?
They are doing the same thing. I just want to demonstrate. Arrow and equal sign, they do the same thing. So you can choose which one you're very comfortable with. I'm comfortable with equal sign. Oh, I just want to demonstrate. It's case sensitive, so big V and small v, they are representing different variable. So next time when you want to give a name, you may want to pay attention. So next time when you want to write big, you already installed 23 into a small value, right? Then you, when you call without the, then you want to call, then you write a big value, it will return your error message because you do not install data into the small, big value, yeah. Okay? Can see now clearly, right? Okay? So you already install, you already put these values in this variable, how to make the computer store it, so you have to run it, right? You just write, you have not run. So how to run, just now I said, you choose it, press run. Ta-da, you see here, global environment. So this global environment will be the environment that store whatever things you already assigned value. So it will be appearing here. Okay, you can run it in that way, then you can also remove it. Okay, after remove it, I just want to demonstrate with you this part. When you use a equal sign, another way of doing it, apart from press a run, what you can do, Mac user can press command return. It do the same thing. Okay? All right. So another, what other things you can do? You can list ls bracket. So it will list whatever values, whatever variables in this computer. So it will list value and value. So these are the variable thing currently stored in your computer RAM. Okay? You can also do in remove, but remove it is very troublesome. You can just press this. It's, that's why I say user friendly, right? You can press button instead of writing code. Okay? So basic syntax, everyone clear? So this is how you write code in R editor. So now I will introduce data type. What's data type? Data type, so whatever data you receive, it will have basically three types. So it can be a numeric data. So what's a numeric data? It's just numbers. So in R, R does not really separate double with integer. So if you learn C before, C has this double int, different type of data. So what's the difference? Integer means just 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, all these numbers. Doubles means they are float numbers. For example, 4.55. That means with a dot, with a decimal dots. That's called a float number, or you can call it double. So in R, R doesn't really care it's an integer or it's a double. So it's whatever numbers, as long as it's numbers, it's called numeric. Another one is a character. So R can also affect character. So what does character means? That means whatever thing that is surrounded by a quotation mark is a character. For example, my name is just a string, right? For example, my name is just a string. So it's a character. So not only it can install numeric, it can also install character. Also, it can store another type of data type. It's called logical, true or false. So it's very important in programming language to know this type of data, which is a logical, or 0 or 1. So sometimes when you want to represent, if you for example, you can visualize a spreadsheet. First column, the name of the students. Second column, have you attended school today? So teacher will mark tick or cross. So you can just replace the tick with a 1, cross with a 0. So these are logical, yes or no. Only 2 options. All right, so these are 3 data types. It's very important to distinguish these 3 data types because later you have to make sure what are the different functions to use. Okay, so another data type is a missing value. Okay, so in R, when R deal with missing value, for example, first column, student name, second column, have you attended school today? Some student, yes, some student, no, some student, no value. Why no value? MC, right? You do not know the student does not attend school, but it's not considered as absenteeism because he has an MC. So what you run? You prefer press put nothing. No yes, no no. You just put a missing value. No record. So in R, it will be represented by a symbol which is called NA. Okay, without quotation mark, NA, just NA, not available. And operation on NA result in NA, so that means if you want to time something with NA, it will produce NA, of course. Nothing times zero, nothing is zero. Nothing times nothing is still nothing. And in R, there is a function called a stop NA bracket to check if there is any missing value inside of the function or inside the data. So, for example, you press, you go to here, X, you assign it to NA. So, it will be, the next time you want to call this X, it will return NA. Okay, just now, if you want, cannot get it, didn't follow. NA is just, I just want to demonstrate, NA is a very special character in R language. That means whenever you do not have any value, you can just use NA to store. Or there is a missing value, the vector, there are some missing values, it will be represented by NA. For example, you just, next time when you have a spreadsheet, some columns are not, some block is not filled. There is nothing there. So in R, when you read in, it will be represented by NA. So I just want to say this, okay? So just now you still remember your value stuff. You can press value. You press enter, where will be the number? 23, because 23, this number is stored in value. Value is called a variable. Okay, next time you call value, it will return 23. So now they are equal, right? So they are interchangeable in that sense. All right? Then you already have your X, right? X can be anything. Variable, right? X is a variable, right? Still remember? It's a variable name. I give it to NA. So when you want to check if X is NA, X, it will return true. So if NA is a logical check, so if you check whatever variable, which is your X or whatever vector, if there is NA inside it. So if there is NA inside, it will return yes. Yes, in computer language means true. Okay, true or false. Okay, easy to follow? So these are three main data type and one more data type, which is a missing data type. Okay? All right, can get, right? Okay, now let's go to the data structure. This part is a little bit hard to understand if you do not have programming language, so please follow me closely if you do not understand. Ask me on the spot. Okay, so what are the basic data structures in R? In R, data are installed in different ways. Okay, you just you can just think data structures are different way of representing data. So for example, the data can be stored in a vector. So in vector, this vector, if you all familiarize with what you learn other languages, for example, C language, people store data in arrays. Okay, so you can think vector is kind of equivalent in R to arrays in C. Okay, vector is just a line of data, of columns of data. So it's just a, for example, you want to know what are the scores of this student's performance in their test. So you will have 100 points, 95 points, 92 points, all this in a, if you want to represent in Excel, it's just one column, right? So a vector is just a, if you extract this whole column as a data structure. So if all the data will be separated by commas, so this is what a vector is. There are also matrix. So matrix you can think of just a table. Okay, so you have horizontal lines, you have vertical lines. So it's a spreadsheet. Matrix is a spreadsheet. Okay, list and array is a little bit complicated. So for your use, most of the time people will use vector and data frame. These two are most commonly used. So I will just emphasize vector and data frame. If you want to know what are the differences between matrix, list, and array, you can go to the, after the class you can check. Okay, so I will introduce vector in detail. This is the most commonly used data type. So what is a data structure and how do you import, how do you design a vector in R? For example, in R there is a function called the concatenate. concatenate function is just a C bracket. Okay? Start with a C. So let's go to your interface. For example, you want to store a variable, give a name. For example, x1. Alright? So you want to store some vector into this x. So you press equal, then you press C. C is containing it. So you want to put 1, 2, 3 in this vector. So you just press 1, 2, 3, separated by comma. Okay? Then you run this line. So you can see in your global environment, x1 is represented by this way. So what's this num? Num is just shows its numeric. Okay? So this data type is numeric. 1, 2, 3. That means in this vector from position 1 to position 3, it has 3 elements. Okay? 1, 2, 3, that means these are the 3 elements stored in this variable. Okay? So you need to understand what does these things mean. So next time when you press x1, what will be returned? Anyone can tell me? 1, 2, 3. Okay? So that means you store this vector in this vector name, x1. Alright? Can follow? Everyone can follow, right? So this is numeric data, right? So what other type of vector you can produce? Okay, the length now is 3, right? You can extend this forever. The length can be extended. Okay, just do a demo, it's length 3. You can just write, you can continue writing this, update this, whatever things you want. Okay? I just do a demo. The length is, you can design whatever length you want. So next, this is numeric data. Now, I want to design a character array, a character vector. So how? X2. I give another one. But still remember, for character, you need to surround them by either a single or double quotation mark. So when you want to design a character, for example, colors. For example, I want red. I want to write yellow. Then I run write blue. Okay? Press enter. So you see in your global environment, there is a CHR. That means character. So the R is smart enough to pick up. Okay, this is our character vector. It stored strings rather than numbers. 1 to 3 means position 1 to position 3. Each of them stored red, yellow, and blue. Okay, so when you press X2, there will be the 3 elements shown on your screen. Okay? Can follow? A bit too fast. I slow down. Okay? Can or not? Okay. So next, you can write another thing. Now we already have numeric character. Next one will be the logical, right? Logical will be represented by true or false. Correct? So what you do? X3 equals to C. Okay. You can write true. In R, true or false, you write them in capital, and it will be highlighted in blue. That's why I say RStudio can have this syntax highlighting. So special phrase or special syntax, it will be represented by a different color, so easier for you to refer. Okay? So true or false. So true, false, true. I just gave a test, then run. So you see in your global environment, X3 is stored logical, okay, logi. And 1 to 3 means position 1 to position 3, each of them is stored true, false, true. So X3, when you press it, it will return this logical vector, okay? So this is how you input data in your R. All right? And another thing is, in R, all these are very busy. Later I will teach you, most of the time you won't press the data yourself. Most of the time, you will give a data set. Okay, you'll be given a data set. Then how you deal with it, later I will teach. This is just a basic. This is how you do it in R language. So if you're familiar with this later part, I will teach you when you have a data set, how you import. Okay, no worries. Okay, another thing is, R is, will be forcing you to make sure in the same vector, it will store the same data type. Okay, for example, you will see here, when you put 1, which is numeric, A, which is with an inverted comma, which means character, and 2. So there are 3 data types, right? R will force it into the same data type. So can you tell me which data type R choose to force it to? Anyone can tell me? Yes, character. R will take them all as a character. When you press 1, this is by right, it's numeric, right? But R, when it returns, it gives an inverted comma to 1. So this one is no longer numeric 1. This one is character 1. The difference between character and numeric, everyone knows, right? Character means string. Numeric means number. Okay? So true will be no longer logistic, no longer be a logical element. Say, you see here, it's no longer blue, right? So it becomes green with the inverted comma. So now true with the inverted comma, it actually means a string. Okay, R will force every different data type into the same data type. So this is you need to be very familiar. And so that actually remind you, next time when you want to use vector, you make sure you input the same data type in the same vector. If not, R will force you to do it. Then next one, you see here, another example is when you press 1 and 2, what R will return you? Numeric, yes. So R will decide to use numeric instead of logical. So because true means 1, right? Do you remember? False means 0. So if you just change true to 1, so it becomes a vector with 1, 1. Okay, so this is just a little bit of what R can do for you. But normally, you do not bother about this part. Most of the time, you will be making sure the same data type in the same vector. So far, can follow? Am I too fast? Okay. So, some important functions in vector generation. Rep, R-E-P bracket. Rep means, yeah, 谢谢. So rep means replicate. What can you do is, you can see from here, you can go to your screen, go to your R interface. You try to press this, you will try to write command line, this line, you try to write it. Rep, C, so can anyone tell me what does this line mean? C means you want to create a vector, right? A, B. A and B, they are character or they are numeric? They are character, right? It's represented by inverted comma, double inverted comma, right? So time equals to 3. That means, what does it mean? That means you want to replicate AB 3 times. So you do not have to really write this time. You can just write 3. It will perform the thing. For example, I can go to the X4 equals to rep. Then you can give A, B, 3. Okay, you can write the time equals to 3. You can also ignore writing the time. So the R is smart enough, it knows the next argument in this function will be the how many times you want to repeat. Okay? So it will repeat A, B, A, B, A, B 3 times. Another thing you want to do is, for example, you want to rep. For example, what you want to do? You want to write, true, false. Yeah, also can. C, true, false, two times. Okay, this is how you write it. Another easy way is to write it is in R there is some cheat way to do it. For example, you can just write rep Can anyone tell me? I just press it. So this is an easy way to write it. So you still remember how R represents a vector? This position 1 to position 3. So next time when you want to use a shortcut to write, instead of using a C bracket concatenate function, you can also use this shortcut, 1 to 2. That means number 1 to number 2. You can, so if you want to generate a sequence of 1 to 100, how? You can choose to write. If you want to generate a sequence, for example, a sequence S equals to 1 to 100, you want to write 1, 2, 3, 4. You want to press it until 100? No, right? It's very silly, right? So a shortcut is you can write 1, colon, 100. Okay? It will generate a sequence for you. Next time when you call S, it will return the sequence. Okay? So this is a shortcut. Use a colon. Okay? So it will be the shortcut for C to generate a sequence. So if you want to see, if you represent 1 to 10 2 times, how you write? Try it. Sec 1 to 10 2 times. Okay? You can write time equals to 2. But R is smart enough, it will know the second argument is the number of time you want to replicate. So you can just save your time by not writing the time equal to. Okay? Oops. Oh, sorry, it's rep, it's not sec. I have not rep. Okay? Replicate, it's not sequence. Alright? So it will return you 1 to 10 2 times. It will give you this sequence. Can? So here, you can see rep 0, 5. So that means it will replicate 0 5 times. So it will give you 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, and start. But this is just a this variable is not stored. This command is not stored in any variable, right? So next time you want to extract this sequence, you have to write this line again. But if you want to store it into some variable, very easy. For example, v, you can give a name, any name you want. You press enter. Next time when you press V, it will return you this. So it's easier. So it just whenever next time you generate a sequence, it's best to store it into some variable. So next time you call a variable name, it will give you this string you just generated. All right? Easy to follow? Now, we already introduced this rep function with replicate. Very useful. Now, we use this sequence. So this sequence, just now I gave you a shortcut, right? 3 to 6, actually a preview. It will be doing the same thing here. So you use sec. Sec stands for sequence. So what can you do? Sec from 3 to 6 by 1, what will be generated? 3, 4, 5, 6. By 1 means the increment. Okay? So what if you have a by right, by 0.5, it will be 3, 3.5, 4, 4.5, 5, 5.5, 6. Okay, so here is another example is 0.2, by 0.2. So you can also ignore this from to by because R is smart enough to let you save the trouble. So let's do it. Sec 1, 5, 0.5. If you know the first argument, will be the starting number, the second number will be the end number, the third number will be the increment number. If you do not have 0.5, that's fine, it's same. If you generate 1 to 5. But if you have the third argument, if you have the increment by 0.5. Okay? So this is how you generate the sequence. You can store it into any vector you want, for example, B. Next time when you call B, it will return the sequence you just generated. Alright, so you can explore, like, for example, length out. What's length out? Length out means whenever the number reach three, length three, it will stop. Okay, but this is less useful. You just need to know how to generate a sequence using sec and how to replicate sequence using rep. Okay, these two are ways to generate sequences. Then this is a shortcut, just now I told you. You can use just a colon, okay, to do a shortcut. But this way you cannot specify the increment. The increment is by default one. So if you want to make sure the increment to be specified, you use sec. Alright? Then another one is, you see here, what does this line mean? This line means, you see the C here? So this actually try to concatenate. Still remember what concatenate means? Concatenate means you add something behind, right? So add anything behind. And you just pull, you can just regard this concatenate function as a ball. You throw ping pong balls inside. So you throw one ping pong ball, which is this, 1, 2, 3. So the sequence 1, 2, 3. You say, then separated by comma, right? Still remember? Then you throw another 9 ping pong ball into this. Then you throw another sequence into this. So there are 3 ping pong balls. Each of them are called an element. So if you return 1, 2, 3, which is defined by this line, 9 is defined by this line, sec 2 to 3 by 0.2. So it will be this line. So if you concatenate, that means join them. Okay? Then you have this new vector. So this is how you how you manually input data into R and store it into variable. This is the most common used function. Okay? Have to be familiar with. Alright? Now, you already have your data stored in your vector. How can you extract the individual element? You can use a for example, B, this vector B, you want to extract a value, for example, you want to extract this 2.5, or you want to extract the fourth value in this vector. How to extract? Very easy. You can just press B, use this square bracket. Okay, square bracket is a way you extract values from your vector. You want to extract which one? The fourth one, you press 4. So what will be returned? Anyone can guess? What will this command return? Yes, 2.5, because it will return the fourth element in this vector. Okay, so this is, after you store values into vector, this is how you extract the values, or extract the elements inside this vector, by its position. Okay, in R, the position start from 1. Okay, unlike C languages, in C language or Java language, it will start from 0. For example, that means in C, when you press 1, that means it's a second element. Okay? But in C, it starts from the first element. So it's just very intuitive. Okay? Then another function is called the length. Length function. Length function will return you the length of the vector. That means how many elements inside that. Okay? For example, you want to press length B. Can anyone give a guess? What's the length? 9. That means the vector B has 9 elements inside. From 1 to 5, separated by 0.5, so there will be 9 of them. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. This function, length function, is very useful later when you want to do a loop. Anyone familiar with a for loop or while loop? Because in the loop, you have to specify the first number, the length, the n number, and the increment, right? The n number, normally you do not want to count yourself, right? So you can just use this length function to extract the length. So this is how you use it. Okay? So length function is very useful in this sense. So far, anyone can follow? Okay. Now we can do arithmetic. So now you already have your vector. What can you do with it? You can play with it by number, by doing basic arithmetic. So for example, you have your B like this. So you have, there are 9 values, right? You have your A, For example, I give a sec. Okay. A will be 1 to 9, B will be 0.1 to 5 separated by 0.5. So they are of equal lines, right? So you can perform arithmetic. So that means if you press A plus B, can anyone guess what will be? It will perform plus element wise. Okay? So it will perform the addition function element wise because A is the first element in A is 1, first element in B is 1. So it will give you a 2. Okay? The second one will be 2, second one will be 1.5, it will give you a 3.5. So whenever you do arithmetic in your vector, it will perform arithmetic element wise. Okay? Corresponding. So if A and B are not of the same length, what will be? Now I give A to R length 8. Then A plus B, what will it be? It will give you warning. You cannot do this because they are of different lengths. Okay, you have to make sure you want to perform arithmetic. Element wise, you have to make sure every element has its pair. Okay, so if you're of different lengths, the system will give you warning. Okay, you cannot do it. See, it's of different shorter lengths. Okay, it will give you warning. Then if you want to do multiplication, then I have to make sure A is the same, right? So I give another A. A is this, B is this. If you want to A times B, it will give you element-wise multiplication. All right? Then what other things you can do, you can also perform indexes for to the power of, okay? To the power of, for example, A to the power of 3, okay? When you do power, you use this sign, okay, as power. Okay, later I will give you a list of how to perform. For example, time is a star, plus is plus plus, minus minus, division is slash. Okay, so we can do A divided by B. Okay? Whatever new things stored, it will be represented here. But so far, we do not have no new variables. So whatever variables were already designed, it will store here. So thus, this region will show whatever variable you have just created. It will be all stored there. So far, so good. Okay, other functions. So apart from this basic arithmetic, plus, minus, multiplication, division, you can also perform sine, cosine, tangent, all this stuff. So it's just like a calculator. Okay? You can also use log or exponential. Okay? Exponential is here. So these are other functions, built-in functions in R. You can just call it. But normally when you call a function, you use a function name, bracket. Okay? By function name, square bracket. What does it mean? So the difference between a bracket and a square bracket. Okay? Function name plus bracket is a function. You need an argument inside this function. Argument means an input. You put this input, then you apply this function. Okay? If you use square bracket, for example, function name square, for example, x, you have this x a squared 2. What does it mean? It means a second element in this A vector. Okay? So you have to make sure the differences between square bracket and bracket. They do different things. Alright? So it's a second element of the A. Okay? Which is 2. Now, everyone familiar with vector? How to deal with vector? Okay? Matrices, list, and array, it will be a little bit complicated. And they are not commonly used in real life. So I will just jump it to data frame. Okay? Most commonly used. If you are interested what matrices, lists, and array is, you can find it yourself after a course. But matrix and data frame are the most important things in R. Okay? Data frame is just a, you can just, it's a list of vector. For example, just now it's a vector, right? Vector, I just say the exam score of all the people taking the test. For example, the 100 point, 95 point, 98 points. Then what's a data frame? Data frame, you can just regard as it's a collection of vectors. You can just regard this. Vector is a two-dimensional. One-dimensional, it has only length. Data frame is two-dimensional. It not only has a length, it also has a rows. Okay? So yeah, in that sense, data frame can store multiple vectors. Then, if you want to visualize it, it's just like a spreadsheet in your Excel. Okay? So, vector, one-dimensional. Data frame, two-dimensional. All right? So, data frame is a list of vectors, so that means you have more vectors, but make sure they are of same length. Same thing, if you are of different length, this data frame cannot be held true. Okay? So, each vector will be treated in columns. In R, the default treatment is columns. So, you can see, data frame can allow different data type. For example, we mentioned data type, you can have a numeric, you have character, you have a logic. So you can see here, if you use a data.frame, you store answer, your A, B, C, D. Can anyone tell me answer is a what type of data type? Yes, sorry?
As a whole?
This answer, it will store what type of data type? String, which is a character, okay? Because it's inverted commas. Okay, answer is a string vector. Correct is a logic vector, which is contains true or false. Mark is a numeric vector, so it will store values. Okay, they are of the same length, which is all five. So when you store it, then you call this data frame. I cannot save. It's fine. So if you press this, I will have a way to it. Okay, it's a figure. Never mind. I cannot copy and paste. I want to do a shortcut to copy paste a code and paste it into the RStudio. By the figure, it doesn't matter. So this is how you design a data frame. So the data frame will return you something like this, which is a table form. And you still remember, it will treat each vector as a column. So you will have your answers as a column here, correct or not as a column here, mark as a column here. It will be each of them correspondingly listed. Then this 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 is just the number of it. Okay? So far, so good. Data frame. So you can, if you are very familiar with vector, data frame is just a collection of vectors. Okay? One dimensional, two dimensional. All right? Now, already introduced data type and basic data structures. Now I will talk about the arithmetic operation, which is only one slide. You can just take note how to perform different way, like addition, subtraction, multiplication, division, exponentiation, integer divide, so you can see the effect. Modulo. Modulo means you take the, you all know, but this is less useful. You just need to know this five. Okay? I just show it. Logical operator means yes or no, equal sign. Okay? So in any languages, you should know equal sign and double equal sign means different thing. Equal sign means assignment of value, okay? Or in R, you can use arrow. Okay, one single equal sign. For example, you write x equals to 3. This means you assign value 3 into variable x, okay? In computer language. But if you write x equals to 3, what does this mean? W double error, double equal sign. Okay, this means you want to perform a logical operation. You want to check if x really equals to 3. You already stored 3 into x, right? So this next command essentially asking you if 3 equals to 3. Okay, is it true? Is 3 equals to 3? Yes, if you return true. Okay, now if you, for example, you assign x equals to 4, then now you press x equals to 3. What will be? False, because now x is a 4. So this command actually essentially asking you if 3 equals to 4. Of course not, right? If you return your false. Okay, so this is called logical operation. So logical operation use equal sign, two equal sign. Okay, this to check if they are equal. Then if you want to check if something not equal to something, then you use not equal, which is a exclamation mark equal. Okay, then for example, we want to go to here, x not equals to 3. Is it true or false? True, because x is 4, right? So this expression just asks you if 4 is not equals to 3, which is true, right? 4 is not equals to 3, it will return you true. Okay, so this is a logical operation. This is very important in any programming language. You have to make familiarize with it yourself. And also, less sign. So you also want to check, condition check. If something smaller than, or something is greater than, or smaller and equal, greater and equal. So all this, you can just do a performer here. For example, now, what's x? X is 4, right? You want to check if x greater than 4 or not. So what will it be? True, right? Because x is 4. So this expression just say 4 greater than 3, which is true. All right? Likewise, you can perform any other things. So last one is exclamation mark. This means logical negation. So exclamation mark in R language is a negation. I think in C it's also exclamation mark. Okay? So still remember, A is NA. This function, A dot NA, what it will do? What it will do for you? It will check if something is NA or not. That means there is no value inside or not. So is NA, what's your value? For example, I have my vector A. I can just use my vector A. Is NA? False. Because NA has value. A has value. It's not NA. Correct. So if for example, I design my own, I can have first value 1, second value 2, third value NA, fourth value 4. So I press my A, if you look at this, right? So if I press my, if NA, so it will return you the third element is true. So third element is NA. Okay, so this is NA function will check if in your vector some missing value inside. This is very useful when you next time you have a very big spreadsheet, your boss give it to you. You want to say if any missing value inside it. So you can extract that vector out, you perform this function, it will check which element has NA inside. So it will, without you eyeballing the missing value, it will tell you where is it. So this is a very useful function.
Then couldn't use the kind of function like A equal to
an
A
cannot,
right?
Equal, what does it mean?
Like the whole vector is equal to an A, that's what we try to do, right? You cannot compare element by element. Is what you are saying?
NA will check, for example, if you put a variable inside, it will check if the variable contains no value. If you put a vector inside is NA, it will check which element inside this vector has missing value.
And also just now, you put a function in the slide, right? You put the numeric 5, right?
Mm.
Then it's returning 5.0. Why is it 0?
5.0.
No, 5.
0.0.0.0.
Oh. You mean this, right?
Numeric.
Oh, numeric. Oh. This one.
Right.
If you, so this numeric is a special function that means it will just return you zeros. Okay, so numeric 5 means you return a string of length 5 or zeros. It's a way of, when you are familiar with, for example, later you want to write loops, for loops or while loops, when you have your, initially, you want to have a vector which contains no values or initially all zero values. Then whenever you run a loop, it will update the values. This is how you do it. So, but most of the time, I prefer NA rather than a string of zeros. Okay? Ken? Sorry?
Logical
Oh, okay. For example, you already know A is this, right? I design my own vector. A, I specify the first value is stop 1, second value stop 2, third value you don't stop, the third position you don't stop anything, NA, missing value. The fourth position you stop 4. Okay, so this is my initial vector. So when I perform this, it's NA check. It will check element wise if inside this each position there is no missing value. Okay, first one. 1 is there, so it's not missing value, right? So is NA, is it not available? No, it's not available. No, it's not available. So it will return a false. Okay, so another false, this third position, okay, it checks, oh, at third position, there is an NA, so it's true. It will return a true. So if you want to put a exclamation mark in front of it, it will reverse everything. So true become false, false become true. So this is how you use exclamation. Okay? So far so good. Now, we just learned how to write the basic vector, how to do the basic syntax. Now what happens when you are given a data set? What can you do? All right, now let's go to data handling. In data handling, what I will teach you will be input output. When you are given a data set, how you input it into R, rather than just now, whatever we do is we press it. We manually introduce vectors, okay? But most of the time in real life, you are not going to do it. You are given a data set. So how to import data into R and let R to do it, okay? That's it, input, output. When you perform your arithmetics or you perform your models, how do you export your data into a data format, for example, TXT or CSV or Excel, so you can open it in another editor. For example, you can open it in CSV, all right? So next, I also introduce you some built-in functions. R has many built-in functions that you can readily use it without you writing the function yourself. But most sometimes, you have to design your own function. So I will teach you in R how to make a function and how to make a design your own function to fill your own needs. Okay, there are specific rules. So let's go to input output. A little bit messy, but go to your R, I give you a R.code in your Google Drive. Anyone found it? It should be in your Google Drive, you download it, you will open it. You open with RStudio. All got it? The R.code.R. So R file will be stored in .R format. Okay? All have it? Just double click the .r file. If you open it, by default, it will be opened by R, but you want to open it by RStudio. Aaron, got it? Yeah, double click. RStudio. Open it by RStudio. All right, everyone got it? Okay, I'll assume everyone have it. So, if you are using Windows, this is how you set your working directory. Because every time you write a code, you want to save it somewhere, right? And or whenever you have input data, you want to save it somewhere. So you have to specify your working directory. In R, if you're using Windows, this is how you do it. Set WD, set working directory. Then you press C. Most of the time, you have a C. User, username, which is your name. I don't know your what name you give it to your computer. If it will be your the name of your computer, for example, your name. Okay, so this is how you set your working directory. Okay, then this dot 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 is you can just put desktop. Okay, you change this username stuff. This is the name of your computer. Okay, Mac. Then you don't have you don't need to use this C dot. Okay, you can just use this way. This is how you change your username. Okay. After that, you put your input.csv. This input.csv is the dummy data file I created for you to practice. So you download this CSV file. You put this data file into the same directory you just designed, you just assigned. If you just now you put directory desktop. Clear? Okay. For example, my so for example, my Mac has a name called Joshua. So if you are going to go to my desktop, so this is how you do it. So now my working directory is set at desktop. So what I want to do is I put this data file into my desktop. Okay? Then when I run this command line, it will read in my data. So this is how you do your reading of data. This is a special command line. It's called read.csv. Okay, another thing is that in R, it can read Excel format, Excel.xl. It can also read TXT. But most of the time, when you want to handle it with R and when it's clean, you use CSV format. Everyone knows what CSV means? CSV means comma separated values. So CSV is the most standard input for R. So next time, whenever you have a data in Excel, for example, you are given a data sheet in Excel, you want to export it into CSV format first. Then you read it in R. Okay? Then you can have this line of code. It's called read.csv. Okay, this is the R function to read CSV. This inverted comma will have your data file name. Okay, next time if you have some data file called a boss assignment. Okay, the boss gave you assignment. It will be boss assignment.csv. Okay, you give a name. Okay, this is a user changeable. Header, what's header? Header means in the data file. Okay. In the data file, the first row will be the row name, a column name. Okay, that's called header. When you are given a data file like this, spreadsheet, most of the time you have a first row, right? First row will be the what each column means. Okay, those is called a header. Then the header, it shows true. So that means, yes, there is a header. Okay, to tell the software, there is header. Sep means separation. Okay, so that's separated by comma. Because it's CSV, right? CSV is separated by comma. But if you are given a TXT file, what happens? TXT, most of the time, it will be separated by tag, right? That means one column, another column, there is no comma, but it's tag, it's an empty space. So then in that sense, you'll change it into a tag, which is nothing. But for more user-friendly experiences, change it into CSV. This is my preference, and I hope it will be everyone's preference. Okay? So this is how you read. How you read data. This line, you can copy-paste. It will be universal. Okay? Then you store without this. It will just read the data. With this, it will store everything read into a variable called data. Okay? So next time when you call your data, when you write data here, it will show you everything in this data, and it will say a rich get option. So that means this is very big. So the screen doesn't want to show it all. So how to show it are very, next time when you want to see if you have already read in data successfully, you can use this special function called heat. Heat means the heat of it. So that means it will give us first six sample, first six rows of it. Okay.
Can you explain why do I need to set
a password? Password? There is no password.
Set
working directory. It's not password. PWD is password.
Yeah.
Okay, it's set working directory. To make sure your input data is within here. So it will read. If you change it into another working directory, then it will not find this input data.
Okay,
because I saved the input data in my desktop. Alright? So hit the data. So next time when you read in your data is very big. The software does not want to show everything. If you can use this trick. Use hit. Hit will just return your first six rows. So you can just have a glance if your data is imported successfully. Okay? It will have say first column ID 1 to 1 to something. So my data set has 2,000 data points. Second column will be the age. Okay, so you can know each row represents a person. Okay? Then the third column will be a gender. Gender is a 1 or 2, so male or female. Correct? Race will be 1 to 4. 1 is Chinese, 2 is Malay, 3 is Indian, 4 is others. So it's a standard Singapore demographic representation. Temperature means the body temperature. Okay? Heart rate means their heart rate. Respirate is the respiratory rate. Then BP low means blood pressure low, blood pressure high. Smoker or not? Yes or no? It's a binary. Yes or no, 0 or 1. Okay? Vaccination, if the person has been vaccinated. Yes or no, 1 or 0. Virus means if the person already got this flu virus. Yes or no. Okay, 0 or 1. So you already see my data set comes from a public health point perspective. So, but it doesn't matter. It's whatever other type of data, you do the same thing. Okay? I just use this example. All right? So, you know how to set directory, you know how to read in the data, and you also need to know how to write data. Okay, not yet. I want to read in first. Okay, now I introduce another thing. It's called a dollar sign. So far, so good. Am I fast? Okay. After you successfully read the data and store the data into a variable called data, you can also change it into another thing if you do want. You can change it into that. Okay? I just prefer it to call data. Easier to refer. Okay? Any variable name will do. Now, I need to extract the columns. Right? Now you are reading at a big data frame, at a big spreadsheet, right? I want to extract individual column. I also want to extract individual element. How? So you have to extract individual column first. How to do that? You use this dollar sign. Dollar sign is to extract individual vector in a big data frame or in a big spreadsheet. Okay? So for example, you use data. You already have, when you go to your hit function, you can see the column names, right? It's called age, gender, race, temperature. So in data, you can press data dollar sign. It will automatically come out with all these things. Okay, so if you know in data it has this column names, you can press, okay, you can choose age. Okay, what will it do when you press enter? It will return a list of vector which shows all the age, 2,000 of them. All right, but still for simplicity, this is very troublesome. We store something inside. We store it, we give a variable name. Rather than every time I use data dollar sign big H, we give it a variable name called H. Use a small a or big A, whatever you want. H. So next time when you press H, it will give you this same string again, same vector again. All right? Okay? So essentially what I do here is I do everything. I give a new name. Okay, age, gender, race, vaccination, I use VAC. Virus, I give virus. Temperature, I use temp. Heart rate, HR. Smoker or not, I use smoker. Okay, so this is how you read data. So now you already have your age. Do you remember age? So what kind of data form, what kind of data structure age is? Age is a vector, right? It has a data structure of vector. What type of vector data is dot numeric? Okay, it's not character, it's numeric. So if you want to perform, you want to check what is the age of the 10th person in this data set? 61. So in that sense, the big data is a spreadsheet. You have rows or columns. You use dollar sign to extract the columns. Then you use this square bracket to extract element inside the columns. So this is how you extract individual data inside your data form. Okay? So far, so good. Now, you already have your... Okay, so now I already introduced you how to extract data. How to, for example, just now your big spreadsheet, you have multiple columns, right? But you are interested only with only three of them. You are interested only with age, gender, race. Okay? You want to create another new spreadsheet with only this three column. Of course, you can open in Excel, delete the tree. Okay, this is a normal way, but in R, you can do this way. But this is just example, because next time when you do, you have your own data file, you only want to export certain columns. This is how you do it. You have two ways to do it. One column, one way is called this cbind function. Cbind means column bind. Okay, that means you bind these columns together. Okay, you bind age, gender, race. Then you assign into a variable called out. Okay, this you can give any name. You can give an output, out, my data, whatever thing. Okay, then you ignore this line. Then you write .csv. Previously you read in CSV, right? You use read.csv. Now you write.csv. Then out will be the variable name. Output.csv will be your output file name. Okay, you want to give a name for the output file. So what will be? What it do is you run this column. Oh, I have not run my all data. Okay, I'll start here. So you see, all it generates will be stored here. It's called integer. Okay, int means integer. 1 to 2,000 means it has a length of 2,000. Each of them is individual value. Then you press this, cbind, write CSV. Okay, now I go to my desktop. Where's my desktop? Oh, here. See? It generates a new file, it's called output. Right? Then you open it, it will have only the three columns you just manually selected. Okay? Can see? Okay? You can also use data.frame. cbind and data.frame do the same thing. You can also perform this role of data. You can also perform this role of command lines. Data frame is doing the same thing. Data frame, if you remember, is will join all vectors into a big spreadsheet, right? Data frame, this what you do. So if you put each generate as a data frame, and you assign to alt. So we perform the same thing. Just your preference. Can? No, no difference. All right. One, two, three, four, five is a serial number. You can delete that. That's a how R store number. If you generate the sequence, the position, so the extra column, you can just delete it. All you want it, you want to keep it. You give a column name called ID, anything here. Right, you got me? This one, you can delete them, or you can just put ID there for your reference. Okay, that's a number, which number of it? The extra column is R auto-generate one. Okay, so far so good, input, output. This is how you do it. The two lines you need to, that's universal. So you can just copy paste whenever you use. Okay, built-in function. This is very interesting part. What R can do with all this stuff. So I just give you an example. For example, hit tail, just now you see, hit return you our first six rows of your big data set. Tail means the last six, okay, the end. Table, what's a table means? Table means it will help you to do a table count. For example, age. What is this? Can anyone tell me? Very complicated, right? So in ages, you remember the person will be from age 18 to age 80. Okay, so if you count, there are 37 of them of age 18. 32 of them age 19. So it will just count for you. So it's easy, right? Very useful function. If you have a very big string, it will help you to count. Okay, so we do a summary for you. In Excel, what you can do is you sort them by age, then you can count. Sometimes you count manually, but in R, if you count for yourself, you see roughly they are about same. Every age is quite uniform distributed. That's why this is actually my makeup data. I purposely made one, so uniform distributed. Okay, okay. This is how table do. Table give you count, summary count. Summary. What summary? Later when I teach you regression, summary very important. But now, don't bother summary too much. Length, just now I show you, return you the length of the vector. So if you have your length, age, where will it be? What will be the number be? 2,000. Because my age has 2,000 elements. I have 2,000 rows, 2,000 elements. Okay, you can see from your variable, 1 to 2,000. Okay, I have 2,000 elements inside. So the length will be 2,000. Sort. What sort mean? Sort will be the, just now the age is all dispersed, right? So every age, you can see from the data file, here, the age is very random, right? Sort give you the sorted number. For example, you press sort, age, it will sort by age. Okay? It will go from the, but this is from smallest to highest. If you want to do a reverse, you can press sort age, comma, the direction will be the reverse. So you can do it whichever way. Okay, so sample. Huh? Your object is not found, you have not run. You see, your age is not here. You have to run all these things. You store them, yes. Not all, just the variables. You run it. Okay, so it will be here. Then you can perform all these things. that has to be stored first. Okay? So far so good? All right, sample. What's sample mean? Sample is very interesting function. That means, for example, sample. Sample means you just draw lots. So next time when you want to do, for example, sample 102, what does it mean? That means from 0 to 100, I want to draw randomly two numbers. Okay? That's how you do sample. Sampling. Okay? Essentially sampling. So that means, so next time when you run it, will you expect the same value? No, because it's random. Next time you run, it will be two different numbers. Okay, so it's sampling. So if you want to do 110, so if you draw number from 0 to 100, 10 of them randomly. Okay, so they do sampling. Okay, in R, when you want to do model, sampling is very important. But you can, next time you want to, this is kind of in Excel, the random number generator. Okay, so it's a random number generator using sample. Sum product, very easy. H, this is the H, right? Can anyone tell me what's the sum of all these things? You do not want to do one by one, right? You can just do a sum, H. Okay? So it will return you the sum of it. Proc, I don't want to do this. This is product. Product, it will be a massive number. Okay? Hope my computer can handle. Infinity. So it's very big. Okay, 2,000 of them, each of them is 2 decimal, it will be very big. So, do a small one. Product, C, 2, 3, 4. Okay, I create a vector myself. I want to do a product of them, 2 times 3 times 4. Product, 24. Okay? Means, all these are statistical ways. So, you are given the age, right? You want to see what the basic age distribution like. You can use mean, which is the average in Excel. 48, okay? Across the 2,000 people, the average age is 48. What's the mean? What's the median? 49, okay? Then what's the maximum number? 80. Minimum number? 18. Okay? Then SD var call. Can you guess what's that? SD, standard variation. Standard deviation. Okay? Call. You do not use call. Call is correlation later. Then you want to do the variance. Variance is actually square of standard deviation, right? Okay? This is all basic statistics. So you are given a vector. You want to summarize the basic statistics. This is what you do. Okay, SD, wow. Okay, variance, standard deviation. Floor, round, what's that? So for example, round means round up or round down. So you know 4.5 will be 5, right? 4.4 will be 4. Hey? So it's a 4.5 still going down. All right? So this is round. To round to the nearest number, nearest whole number. You can also do the floor. Floor means the nearest whole number, which minus 1, right? Ceiling will be the top. Floor will be the lower. So this will be 4. Then you can also do ceiling. It's 5. Okay? So this is the basic operators. So you can see more in R built-in function.pdf, I already uploaded the file. So I have a more list of this readily built-in function in R. Okay, you can find it in this PDF. Okay? This is how you can use R to perform all this basic arithmetic. Now, make function is interesting. This is part you want to, I want to give some exercise for you. In R, how you make your own function. Just now, whatever thing you just called, for example, mean bracket, standard deviation bracket, all these are ready-made built-in function. That means the function inside is already saved in R language. So you do not know how it performed in the, internally, but somehow when you input, you give it an argument or give an input, we will run this function and return you something. Okay? This is internally built. But what if you want to design your own function? For example, you want to calculate your BMI. You all know BMI? Body mass index, right? Your weight divided by your height times square, right? You want to calculate the BMI of a certain group of people. How? Then this is how you design your own function. This is a language format. My function name, you can give any function name, for example, BMI, okay? Equals to function. This one, you have to write function. Input 1, input 2, input 3, these are argument. So that means, what are the input data you put into your function? If you can have two, if you want to calculate BMI, what are the two input? Weight, height, right? So you have two input, or you can regard it as argument 1, argument 2. Statement, then you use a big bracket. Statement 1, statement 2, statement 3, these are all the arithmetic you perform. Okay? Return an object, so what you return? The return object is this function give you what? After you input the data, they return, this function will give you something, right? You give an argument to this function. After the function runs internally, it will output something for you. So this return thing is an object. So you want to return one. So let me do a demonstration. Not break. This one after this will be break. Okay, I have already read the basic make function 1. For example, you can have a look here. Function name, my function name, I give it a call, a BMI. Anything you want, any function name, any name you want. Function, standard, is highlighted in pink, right? So that's called syntax highlighting. You have to write function. Bracket, you have two arguments. First argument is called weight, second argument is called height. Okay? You can also write A or B, but for the easier to read, you give it a name. Okay? Height, weight or height. Then you perform your arithmetic. The big bracket, body mass index, BMI, equals to weight divided by height times square. Okay? So remember how to do it? This is very easy, right? Weight divided by height bracket times height times time. Height times height. Okay? So this is your internally function. Then you return. What you return? You return this BMI, right? You want to return a value called BMI. So this function, you design your own function, it's called BMI, then you run it. Okay. Now you design your own function rule. Next time when you call your function like BMI, what's the weight, what's the height? For example, height, weight, 60 kilogram. Height, 1.7. This function will return you a 20.7. This, how you get the number, if you essentially put this 60 corresponding to your weight, put your 1.7 corresponding to your height, then if you perform this weight and height correlation, then assign it to the body mass index variable and return this variable. Then this return variable will be this number. So this is how you design your own function. You can make it more complicated, you can have more things inside. Okay? So this return object is a numeric number, right? Okay? Just now in my slide, I say you can return a numeric or you can also return a logic number. Logic, that means you return true or false. So we do an update of this function, called function 2. I want to check. I give you a weight, I give you a height. I want to check if you are healthy, if you are fit or not. According to the MOH guideline, if you have BMI of 20 to 25, you're considered fit. So I just want to give you me your two values. I want to check if fit or not. I don't want to spot the value myself, then I decide. I want the computer to decide for myself. So how? Same thing. You have your weight, you have a height. Then you design a function, it's called body mass index, how you calculate, right? Then I put this fitness as a false. Initially, I assign a false to this fitness, fit or not. Okay? If you are fit, then I will replace this false to a true. If you are not fit, it will return a false. Okay, so this is called initial value assignment. Most of the time, we give a false first. Then if you are fit, then we update. Okay, so now I use a condition check, if statement. Every computer language will have if statement, right? If bracket, body max index greater or equals to 20. Okay, this double and means condition and. It means in logical and. That means you have to match both function. You have to match both statement condition. Yeah. Okay. So and body max index smaller or equals to 25. So this is my condition. Okay. You have to match both. Then if this is matched, I will assign true to fitness. Initially, I assign false to it, right? It will be false. But later, if this is true, I will assign true to it. So fitness now become changed. But if this is false, if you are under 20 or greater than 25, this command is not run. Because condition check, you have to match this function, then you run this line. If condition check does not match this function, this line is not run. Okay? So essentially, the software will give you return the fitness. It will return true or false. Okay? Easy to understand this function. Then we run this function. Now we have this function called bmifit. Give you a weight, for example, 60. Height, 1.7. True, that means if you have this height and this weight, you are fit. Okay? If you have this 1.9, too skinny. Okay? So it will return false. So you can see, this is how you build your own function. It can return values. It can also return this condition check. Okay, sorry, this kind of logical true or false. So this is called your own program. Okay, you can do with other things, whatever you think you want. All right, break. Yeah, 2 hours, that's nice. Okay, any question you can ask me, you have 2 hours break, right, until 2? I think start from 2 to 4, right? 1 hour. Okay, then we can release early. Alright, everyone clear, right?
I have some housekeeping rules here because I got a complaint from the IBA. So, no food is allowed in the venue. It's outside, so don't bring it to the room.
Mm-hmm. 好的，行。
I cannot open the hall, the into hall.
Cannot open?
Yeah.
Have you put into the...
That's all right.
Small. D is big. The rest is small. D is big. The rest is small. Yeah, then you run again. Can I go to your desktop? It's here. .csv, right? I think...
Username is wrong.
You go to your C document. Go to your C... Wait. This is Yihan. Small one. Your Y is big. Okay. So let's start early. So for session 2, I will introduce about the regression models. So this is very important models when you deal with data, because whatever data set you are given with, normally you want to find the association between the data set. And a regression model is kind of model that tell you the relationship between two data sets. And also after this, I will teach you visualization. That means I already said R is not only very powerful in terms of doing statistics, it's also very powerful to plot figures, beautiful figures. Okay? So let's start with regression model. So before I come with introduce regression model in detail, we have to understand what are the data types regression model work with. So normally you are given a data. The data can be of this qualitative or quantitative type. So if it's a qualitative, it can be either binary or categorical. So binary just means logical, yes or no, zero or one. So only two cases. Categorical means they are categorized. So it can be, for example, race. Age, you have a Chinese, Malay, Indian, or others. So they are categorized. They are not values. They are so-called, when you match it to the computing language, it's kind of the characterized, data type. And the binary data type refers to the, is equivalent to the logical data type. Okay? Then quantitative means either the data can be continuous or discrete. Continuous, for example, the height, it can take decimals, so you can infinitely divide the data into smaller intervals, so you have a 61.0 or 62.3, something like this. Or it can be discrete. Discrete, that means it can only take certain numbers. So like, for example, shoe size. You can have a 40, size 40 or size 41. You won't have a size 40.5. You won't have a size 40.3, for example. So this is a discrete numbers. So after that, I will introduce regression model with bear in mind about the data type. Okay, later you need to refer back frequently. So regression models, what is a regression model? They are statistical methods to investigate the association between variables. So when I say association, it's not causality. Okay, this it must be very clear. Association is not causality. Two data sets associated does not mean one data set caused the effect of the other. Okay. So I will introduce two types of regression models. Simple linear regression, multiple linear regression, or multivariate regression, another name, and a logistic linear regression. So I will teach them one by one. A little bit of background statistics. So what is a simple linear regression? So it actually is a model that wants to see the linear relationship between a variable y. This y must be continuous variable. Okay, still remember, it can be only continuous. It cannot be logistic. It cannot be categorical. Okay, y must be continuous. And a single variable x. So this x can be any y. So that means can be any type. It can be categorical, can be continuous, can be discrete, can be binary. Okay, so y has another name. Sometimes when you see y can be called a response variable, or it can be called dependent variable, or it can be called outcome variable. Okay, so these are all the different names given to y. X can be called a predictor, or it can be called independent, or exposure, or explanatory variable. So this is a name. Next time when you encounter this kind of name, you know which one refers to X, which one refers to Y. So what's a linear regression model? Linear regression model, still remember, anyone learn based, like secondary school math, you should know linear relationship between Y and X, right? Y equals to AX plus B, correct? So this is the Y and X I refer to. The Y is the Y here. The X is the X here. The A and the B, I use another annotation, which is a beta 0 and a beta 1. Okay? So you can regard the AX, Y equals AX plus B, the formula you learn in secondary school. The A will be the beta 1 here. The B, which intersect, will be the beta 0 here. Okay? Then this small sign here will be the error term, which we want to minimize. So whenever you want to do model that, what a model is, model want to see if it matches the reality. But there are always an uncertainty between model and the reality. So this small error term captures that. And we want to minimize this so that the model will capture the reality as close as possible. So this is a basic formula like this. Essentially the same as the secondary school, y equals to ax plus b. Okay, so we want to use a linear line to fit the data. Data is scatter plot. Okay? So in R, what's a code in R? So in R, you use this line of code, LM, linear regression model, Y, title, X. Okay? Let's go to your here. So still remember, previously everyone already run that data code, the output.csv, right? We are still using that data as our demonstration, to for our demonstration. So still remember, temp means the temperature, HR means the heart rate, right? Correct? So I will run this linear model, so I want to model, so temp will be the y variable, HR, heart rate will be the x variable. So we want to see if this x, H heart rate, and this y temperature are correlated. So you think about it, heart rate and temperature. Intuitively, if your heart rate beats faster, you should have a higher metabolism rate, right? So you should have higher temperature, right? Intuitively, so this should be positively correlated, and we want to test it if it is true. Okay, so how to do it? LM, temperature, heart rate, run it, run this line. So the linear regression model data will be stored in this fit variable. And you can give it anything you want. You can put a fit, you can put a model, you can put anything you want. It's just a variable to store the values. Then now you use summary. Summary is just now I mentioned about this is a built-in function. It will give you the summary of this model. So you run the second line, it will give you this. A lot of stuff. I will tell you what each of them mean. So you can see here, it will give you the residue which you do not bother. The things you need to pay attention is here. These two values is the estimate. The estimate here, this is called the intercept, right? 3.71, okay? It's 3.71 times 10 to the power of 1, so which is essentially 3.71. 3.71 is the intercept. So in our y equals to ax plus b, this 3.71 will be the b, correct? And this estimate corresponds to the heart rate. This estimate is about 0.0098 to the power of minus 3, right? So 0.009. This one will be the coefficient of your line equation, right? Which is a, right? Y equals to ax plus b, right? So B is the intercept, which is this number, intercept. This one will be the A, which is the coefficient of this variable. So this is the A. Okay? So you also need to pay attention to here, P. This value is very important for you to determine if this model really fit. Still remember, anyone learn basic statistics? What's a gold standard of something is statistically significant. P smaller than 0.05, right? This is really, really small. This is means 2 times 10 to the power of minus 16. This is definitely smaller than your 0.05. Okay? So that means this estimate is very statistically significant. You can also just look at the stars, you may know. See here, the intersect, it gives a 3 star, so that means it's very significant. All right, so. Anyone can follow? Okay, so in my code, summary.fit, just now what you have is summary.fit, and confidence interval fit. What does this line of code do? You know anything comes with uncertainty when in statistics, okay? 95% confidence interval, you heard this term before? That is kind of, you are 95, okay, I'm using layman language, but this is not statistically correct. So you have 95% confidence that your true value lie within this range. So you have, when you run this, config.defaultfit, you can have 2.5% and 97.5%. That means we actually enclose about 95% of the whole data, and you are 95% confident that your true estimate will lie within between 0.08 to 0.011. Still remember previously we calculated the estimate is how much? 0.009, right? Here. This is the estimate. This is 0.0098. Okay? So whenever you want to report, you also report confidence interval. This is our practice. Okay? So now I actually give you example in advance. By right, I want to show you three examples. So still remember I say the Y variables or the outcome variables must be continuous, okay? Then but the X variables can be any data type. So I want to demonstrate with you three examples, continuous Y and continuous X, which is essentially just now what I did here. Continuous Y and continuous X, so body temperature is continuous variable, so it's a continuous type data type. Heart rate is also continuous, so that means you have a different data, it's not categorical. So after we run it, you can have see here, this is a print screen, it's essentially the same thing just now I performed. You have this value, you have this value. So one, you want to fit into a line, so you have all these dots, you want to fit into a line. Do you know like, how the data looks like when you have when you want to correlate them? For example, by right, I should teach this. I shouldn't teach this. This is a later part. Oh, okay. I see. Okay, so this is actually what the data is, 2,000 points. Okay, so what essentially a regression want to do is, you see this is each individual point corresponding to their temperature and heart rate. Okay, so this is how it looks like for the 2,000 points. And linear regression model just want to fit a line that try to explain all these patterns. So I don't want to fit a line here. Okay, what's a line characteristic? So you have to know the slope, you have to know the intersect with y-axis. So this essentially tells you. So this essentially tells you about what is the slope, what is the intersect. So you can write temperature, which is a y variable, equals to 3.71, which is the intersect, which is the b, y equals to b plus ax, right? Plus AX, X is the heart rate. The coefficient of it is 0.00987. Okay? So this is the equation. So the R software, just using one line of code, which is called LM bracket, Y title X, it will fit this line, and this line will try to explain every element in that data set. Okay? What does this number mean? This equation means when there is a heart rate increased by 1, whenever you have heart rate increased by 1, then your body temperature will increase by how much? This much, right? Because every time you increase by 1, your body temperature increased by this amount. Your baseline is 3.71. Get me? Okay? And the P is smaller than 0.01. Okay, this is a practice because it's too small, we don't write the exact P. And this is a confidence interval. So we are 95% confident that whenever you have your heart rate increased by 1, your body temperature will be 3.71 plus this number times your heart rate. So we can find this linear relationship. So next time, so this 2,000 data point will be kind of a training data set. Next time, I generate this relationship. So next time, I'm given your heart rate, for example, a random people walking, say, okay, I have a heart rate of 130 per minute. Or can you guess my body temperature? Then I just say your heart rate, I say, okay, your body temperature is this, roughly. And this will be 95% confidently true for most of the time. Okay, so this is how you do simple linear regression. Very easy to find the relationship between X and Y. Okay, so exercise. You already know like how to do a continuous Y and continuous X. What happens if you have your continuous Y and binary x. So your x variable will become binary. For example, I ask you, I give you an example. Your y still be your body temperature, and the x will be the virus status. For example, have you been infected by flu virus? Right? Intuitively, if you are infected by flu virus, your body temperature will rise. Correct? You want to test it. If it is true, do it. Your exercise. How? Can anyone guess how? Yeah, actually I write it down. Don't look at it. Don't look at it here. Block it. Do it your own code. This is my first one, right? The general code looks like this. Now what you need to do is change heart rate to virus, right? Because previously what the variables here, virus is stored in a variable called virus. Okay, it's a binary. Still remember? Still remember? I use a table to do the summary for me. Virus is actually a binary. Okay, yes or no. So about 100 plus people have virus. Okay? So how? Anyone can tell me? Essentially, what you need to do is just change the heart rate to virus. Okay, very easy. Okay, so how it looks like? You want to see if the temperature and virus, how they correlated. Cannot see, right? Because it does not look like the previously the cluster, right? Previously, it's a cluster of them. But now you have two lines. Why? Because your x variable is only binary. Okay? Then how to find the relationship? You still use a linear regression model, which is the temperature is your y response, virus is your x variable. You run this code. You store it into fit2. Okay? Previously, we used a fit. Now we use a fit2, so it's a different model. So it store into different variable. So when you give a summary of this fit too. Which is also here. E? It's the same here. Okay? Body temperature virus. After you run it, data virus will have this intersect. 0.25. Sorry, this is the estimate of the beta. This is your slope. Okay? This is the intersect. So essentially you can write the linear relationship between virus and temperature. Temperature equals to 38.1 plus 0.25 slope. This is your intersect. This is your slope times virus. So this one times this virus status. So virus status can only take 0 or 1, right? Correct. So if you take 0, this term cancel, right? Correct. Know this term. So your average body temperature is 38.1. So across all 2,000 people, the average body temperature is 38. Okay?
How does the 0.177 and the 0.7,
how does this two number come out? Oh, the confidence interval, here. You run this line. Confidence interval. After you run the summary, right, you also need to run the confidence interval. That means because the summary gives you the estimate, it's a just single number, the slope will be this number, 0.25. This is slope. But any model comes with a confidence interval. Okay? So it's not a fixed number because they want to do a model. Model want to match a reality data set. So there will be definitely some uncertainties, okay? The uncertainties is captured by this term called 95% confidence interval, okay? Then how to calculate the 95% confidence interval? You use this line called confidence interval, okay? Dot default, then your stored model, then it will return you these two numbers, 0.008 and 0.11. OK? So actually, this is for the FIT2, sorry. Because we are doing the second demonstration, so this is a confidence interval 0.17 to 0.33. So we found out that the estimate is 0.25, right? So when you report, when virus status is 1, so it's 0 or 1, right? If it's 0, that means average temperature is 38.1. If you are 1, your temperature will be 38.1 plus 0.25, right? So that means if you have virus, you are 0.25 degree higher than those people do not have virus. So this makes sense. It's you get virus, you get fever. Okay? So and this is made up data. This is not real data. I made up with myself one. So real data, you shouldn't have expect people have normal temperature 38, right? So this is for demonstration. Do not say the data makes sense or not. And the P, you have to look at here. Whenever you have this reported A, which is the beta estimate, you also need to look at the P. If the P correspondingly is smaller than 0.05, okay? If it is, then this is statistically significant estimate. If not, then this model does not fit. You do not use the model. Okay? The model tells you rubbish. Okay? So this is your answer, how you report data. Another one. What if you want to do a continuous X and categorical Y? Categorical Y, huh? Inside the data set, which are the variables? Those are categorical. Can you give me an example? You go up, all of them. Race, okay? Race is categorical because it's 1, 2, 3, 4, still remember? Okay? 1, 2, 3, 4, they refers to Chinese, Malay, Indian, and others, okay? But when you run the model, you see here it's called factor race. Why I have this extra term called factor? Because this factor tells the computer that race is a categorical variable. If not, if you remember, race is represented by 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay? If without this factor, the computer will think race is 1, 2, 3, 4 numeric. Okay? Because 1, 2, 3, 4 you want it to represent a categorical. So you use this factor to tell the computer this 1, 2, 3, 4 does not mean number 1, 2, 3, 4. They mean four different category. Okay, so this is how you use factor. Then you run it. Summary tree. Look at data. So you see, risk one is not here. Correct. It only tells you risk one, risk two, risk three, risk four. Risk 1 is not here, so risk 1 is our Chinese race. So the software will take one first of them at the baseline. So you compare the baseline with others. So later when I teach later part, I will teach this in detail, how to interpret the data. But now you can just think Chinese is not there, but now you only have Malay, Indian, and others, okay? Look at the P first before you look at the estimate. P. Are they significant? No, they are not significant. All of them are greater than 0.05, right? So you do not have to do anything. You can just conclude. Race does not determine body temperature. Okay? It makes sense, right? No matter what race you are, your body temperature won't be dependent on your race. You cannot say if you're Malay, you have higher temperature. If you're Chinese, you have lower temperature, right? Correct? So this tells you body temperature does not affect. Sorry. Race does not affect your body temperature. There are no association between the two. Okay? Just look at the P. P significant, then they are correlated. P not significant, no. This is how you make conclusions based on the P. All right. So here, I say risk based on here, you can see the p are all greater than 0.05. So they are not statistically significant. Risk 1, Chinese is the baseline. So since all are greater than this, they are not significant predictor. So what you can conclude is there is no difference in body temperature among different races. So this is how you make conclusions. Okay? Even though the p is not significant, you can still draw a conclusion. The conclusion is there is no association. Okay? Now let's discuss. Simple linear regression. Just now we already see three types of, I give you three examples of simple linear regression. So you have one y, which can only be continuous, okay? You can have one x. X can be categorical, can be binary, can be continuous, okay? Whatever data type you want, it can all give you results. But you already see, just now I use a heart rate. So you remember first example, heart rate, with the continuous. Heart rate is correlated with body temperature. Still remember? First example. Higher temperature, higher heart rate, higher body temperature. Second, we use a viral status as example. Viral status can also affect body temperature. If you have virus, you have higher body temperature. But which one are really causing the body temperature to rise? There are two factors, right? Individually, viral status and heart rate both can cause positive higher body temperature, but which one is really causing it? So you want to do this test. You want to know which one really caused, then you have to do this multiple linear regression, not only one single parameter. Get me? So what you do is, you introduce this multiple linear regression. You see the equation here is a little bit different than your previous one. Previous one, you only have this. Correct? You only have one x variable. Now you can introduce more. Because previously, individually, you know, virus, yes, possible to cause body temperature to rise. Then your race, no. But your, what's the first one? The heart rate can also cause, right? So you want to put them into a single linear regression. Then it is called multiple linear regression. So you can actually mean everything you dump in. Okay, you want to see if you have any interaction. Okay? Very easy. Previously, only one to one. Now it's many to one. Okay? So that means, essentially, your y variable can only be continuous. I want to emphasize again, y must be continuous. X can be any type. Then you can have multiple, more than one x. So that means you have more x to fit the line. This is called multiple linear regression. All right? So in code in R, what to do? Same. Previously, you only have y tidal x. Now you have y tidal x1 plus x2 plus x3, whatever things you want to put in. As many as variables you want. You just use a plus sign to add them together. Okay? So let's go to the R code. Multivariate linear regression. Okay, multivariate and multiple is the same. So we want to see if virus and heart rate both affect temperature. Okay, individually they are affecting temperature. Now we want to see, put them together. Heart rate and virus, put them together. We'll assign it into your multivariate regression. Okay, you give a name, any name. Run it. What can you see here? Okay, this is too big. Look at the code. It's the same thing I already prepared here. So, your y will be your body temperature. X, you have two x. X1, heart rate. X2, viral status. So you have this outcome. You have your heart rate, you have this estimate. Virus, you have this estimate. Are both significant? Yes, right. These two numbers are definitely very small. This e to the power of minus 11. Okay, that means 0.00110. Okay, it's very small. So with this, what can you interpret the data? Each of them are the estimates. This is the intersect. Just by substitute the value back to your equation, it will be temperature equals to 37.13 estimate. Okay? It's 3.7 to the ten to the power of 1, right? So that means this number times 10. 37.13 plus this is your heart rate. Heart rate times this value come from where? Come from here. Plus viral status times your 2.5. Okay, 0.25. Okay, this is 0.25. So this is your new equation. So this new equation will tell you when you are given heart rate and viral status, I can use these two variables to predict your body temperature. Okay, if there are only one. How? So now I say, with virus, if with virus, this one will be 0.25, right? With virus means 1, right? Am I too fast? Can follow, right? With virus status will be 1, so there will be 0.25. You have 0.25 plus 37.1, you have 37.38. Okay, so these two values I'll add to get this. Equals plus this term. So without virus, without flu virus, so there is 0, so this term cancelled. You only left with 37.13 plus this. So can you see? Now you have extra information. So when you want to calculate or predict your temperature, I can use your heart rate to predict your body temperature, but I ask you an additional question. Do you have virus infected? If you have virus infected, I can modify my prediction by a little bit. Then I use this equation to calculate. So that you see, this is more information or more detailed, rather than just you give me your body temperature, you give me your heart rate, I want to calculate. Now I ask you an extra information. Do you have virus? Have virus? Then I modify my equation a little bit. Yes or no? Sorry? This is a coefficient. Estimate means a coefficient. Estimate this. So this estimate, this betas are called estimate. Okay, so this beta 0 is the intersect. Okay, so this is x1, which is the heart rate. This x2 is your virus. Beta 1 and beta 2 are the estimate, which is this two number. Okay, so you see now, multivariate regression analysis actually give you the breakdown, further breakdown to describe your data. So you see, it's easier, it's more accurate in that sense, because you have two independent variables that affecting your body temperature. Then now I take account of both variables. Okay, so this is multivariate regression. Discussion. So in both simple and multiple linear regression, why must be continuous? You remember, every time I do this, I emphasize why must be continuous. But in some cases, why may not be very continuous? What happens, for example, why it's binary? For example, you want to see the outcome variable, because previously the outcome variable is body temperature, right? Why variable? Why is body temperature? It's continuous variable. But what happens? Your outcome will be your, for example, ring or not. Does not ring? Ring or not? Ring or not? Yes or no? You want to predict this. For example, you want to predict, does the gender, for example, let me see, eat some drug, okay? Cause death or not? For example, in a clinical setting, the doctor give you drug. Then the drug death or not, it may not be sounds good. Side effect, okay? Side effect, yes or no. So you eat the drug. The eat drug or not is your X, right? So your X variable, which is a binary, yes or no. Then your outcome variable is also, do you have side effect? This outcome Y is no longer like temperature, which is continuous. This outcome variable Y now is binary, yes or no. So you want to see if eating the drug causes your side effect or not. So this is the X and Y correlation. This Y will be the binary Y. Okay? Then how to deal this kind of situation where your Y is no longer continuous, but rather a binary? We use logistic linear regression. Okay? A little bit problematic in terms of mathematics, but I just want to show the math, but back in the internally how it's done, you do not have to bother about this. You just need to know how to use it. Okay? So when your Y becomes a binary, yes or no, or 0 or 1, you change the Y into a log P divided by 1 minus P. P is the probability of getting the problem. For example, in a list, previously I gave you either drug cost. Do I have a? Okay. Okay, I try to. You just think about two columns. Okay. One column is X, which is either drug or not. 0 or 1. One column is Y, which is do you have a side effect, which is the outcome variable. Okay? Y. 0, 1, 0, 1, 0, 1. So, for example, you have 100 of them. How many of them are 1? How many of them are 0? You can count, right? For example, in 100 of them, you have 50 people have side effect. Not 50, 30 of them have side effect. Then what is the probability of people getting side effect? Zero point three, right? Correct. You have 100 of them, 30 of them get. So you have what's the probability of people getting side effect? Then use 30 divided by 100, right? 0.3. So essentially, if 0.3 will be the probability, then you sub 0.3 to the p. This is the p. So 1 minus p will be the 0.7. Then you use this divided by this. This is called the odds ratio. There's the odds of getting the side effect. Okay? Then you do a log. Why do you need to do a log here? You do a log transformation. The reason why, because you see x variable can take values. I say x variable can take any type, right? So when you run to fit a model, your x and the y, the range must be the same. When I say range, it's data range. So x variable can take any number from negative infinity to positive infinity, correct? But now your y can only take 0 or 1, correct? So you want to change your y or transform your y into a range from negative infinity to positive infinity. How? This is how we do the math trick. Probability can only take 0 to 1, right? Correct. Then 1 minus probability can also be a number of 0 to 1. You use the range from 0 to 1 divided by 0 to 1, you get 0 to 1, 0 to infinity, right? Correct. So without log, this part, the value range will be 0 to positive infinity. Okay? But you need a y value from negative infinity to positive infinity. How? You do a log. Right? You do a log transformation. Then log transformation will change 0 to positive infinity to negative infinity to positive infinity. So okay, this is a math background, but you do not need to bother this. I just want to introduce you this read odds ratio. So instead of writing a y here, okay, for logistic regression, means your outcome variable y is binary. Instead of y, you use this thing, log p divided by 1 minus p. The right-hand side is the same. All right? So I introduce a term which is called the odds ratio. So the odds ratio will compare the odds of outcome will occur in an exposure to the odds of the outcome will occur without exposure. Just now I explained about the 100 patient thing. 100 patients, out of them, 30 people have side effect. So the p will be 0.3. The 1 minus p will be 0.7. So 0.3 divided by 0.7, this is the odds ratio. So this odds ratio describes the odds of the outcome, which is that people will get side effect with an exposure, which is eating the drug, to the odds of outcome will get the side effect without exposure, without eating the drug. So this odds ratio is how you interpret this. And when you run, you see, because now your y is odds, right? It's a log ratio. So when you want to calculate the estimates, which are essentially previously what we calculate the estimates, you need to do exponential, right? Because now you do a log, you want to refer it back you have to do an exponential. Correct? So whatever beta here, you have to do the exponential to get your odds ratio. Okay? So I will, okay, this is a little bit math, but I will teach you how to interpret. So how to do it in R? Same thing. Now, still remember previously we put LM. See the difference? Now you have a G in front of it. Previously you used LM. LM means linear model. Okay? Now you have GLM. G means generalized linear model because the function wants to generalize it into more, you have more powers. Okay, so this is the difference. Use GLM instead of M, LM. Then your Y variable, which is your what? Binary, right? Then X1, X2, X3. You can have all your different input variable. Now you need to put this extra thing, which is called family equals to binomial. Binomial distribution, you heard that before? That means yes or no, right? So you want to make sure this GLM using a model, which is a binomial model, you have to include this line here. So how to do it? Logistic regression. For example, I want to see the virus status. For example, I want to see the virus status and the vaccination. Vac means vaccination. I want to see if you have vaccinated before, do you still have get infected by the virus? Okay? Intuitively, what's the answer should be? If you're vaccinated before, you shouldn't get the virus. Right? So how do we test it? We can have a GLM. We want to see virus status, which is a binary. Do you have it or not? This is your Y variable. VAC is the vaccination with your X variable. Family is a binomial because you tell your R to see this is a binary equation. This is a logistic regression. Okay, this is not linear regression. Normal linear regression. Then you do this thing. Run. You can see here, is the p significant? Yes. Okay, first thing first, you need to look at the p. P is not significant. If p is not significant, you do not have, do not need to do anything. So this model is invalid. Okay? If it is significant, then you further try to analyze it. If significant, then you look at here, estimate. This estimate, still remember, this is a log estimate. You need to do an exponential. Still remember. Because this is a log odds ratio. So unlike previous, the simple regression and multiple regression, you just take this estimate as your beta, as your slope, or y equals to ax plus b, the a. Instead of just plug this number in, this number you need to do an exponential. Okay? That means e to the power of minus 2.53. Okay? But this you do not have to do manually. You can just draw this line. This line. Called S. That means coefficient. Okay? Coefficient means this, right? This is the coefficient. This means the estimate. Estimate coefficient. Okay? In the R language, it's called S. This is your model. You use called S to extract this number. You can also type. You can also extract. Okay? Then exponentiate. So this 0.08 will be your odds ratio. Okay? Then later I will teach you how to interpret odds ratio. Alright? So you have to get this number out first. Instead of just look at this minus, instead of using this number, the estimate coefficient, in logistic regression, you have to exponentiate first. Okay, how to exponentiate? You can do this. You can manually do it. Okay, you can also call it. For example, how to call it is just this this equation. Call f, this equation will extract the number. This function will extract the number out. Then you do the exponential. If you do not want to type, then you can just call it. Okay? So this 0.08, what does it mean? So this is a 0.25 minus 0.25. Do not use it directly in logistic regression. You need to exponentiate first. Okay? So the odds ratio will be 0.08. How to interpret? The interpretation will be people who have received the vaccine are 92% less likely to have a virus. Because now you want to do odds, right? Odds is doing a comparison. So 0.08 means people who have the vaccination are at the 0.08 region. Who do not receive vaccination are at a 0.92 region. So you can think about 1 minus this number. So the odds ratio will be 1 minus the odds ratio will be the person who receive the vaccination. Is it confusing? Is it confusing? A little bit? Okay. You all know how to get this number, right? This number is just when you do the when you run the model, it will return your estimate. Then this estimate you cannot use directly. You do the exponential because logistic regression, like the name suggests, is log, right? Logistic, log. When you do log, you want to refer back to the original number, you have to exponentiate. Okay? You log a number, you exponentiate a number, it will go back. So exponentiate the number will return you a 0.08. This 0.08 is the odds ratio. This odds ratio actually tells you people who, do you remember how I define odds ratio? People who receive and who do not receive, right? Odds is P divided by 1 minus P. So P is the people who have it. 1 minus P is who do not have it. So this odds ratio actually tells you the proportion. Correct? P divided by 1 minus P, right? It's a proportion. So in another word, if the odds of people who get vaccination are at the 0.08 region, then it will be, in other words, it to say people who get vaccination are 92% less likely to get the virus. This 92 is 1 minus 0.08. Okay? So this makes sense. People who get the vaccination are 90% less likely to get the virus than those who didn't get the vaccination. So this data tells you, and also tells you the exact number. Okay? So this is very powerful in terms of interpreting data. You want to know if this vaccination work or not. Yes, this vaccination really work and make people 92% more protective against the virus. Okay? You can apply it to other scenarios. This is how you interpret odds ratio, okay? Binary Y, binary X. What happens if you have other type of data? Binary Y, continuous X. And binary Y, categorical X. Can you do your exercise yourself? For example, you look at the data, initial data. Apart from the virus status, who else is binary? Your data, right? Still, how you see your data? Hit, right? You want to check your data. Virus is 0, 0, 0. Who else is 0 or 1? Smoker or not, right? If the participant is a smoker. Or if you see a vaccination, smoker, and the virus status, they are all 0 or 1. Okay? So we can use the example of smoker. We want to see. We want to see if the age is a factor for smoker. Okay, age is a continuous, right? So we want to see if age affects the smoker's smoking status. That means if age determines if you smoke or not. Okay, intuitively, yes or no? No, right? By right, should be no. It's not saying like if you're getting older, you are more likely to be a smoker, right? So it's independent. So intuitively, age and the smoker are not correlated at all. So we want to test it if it's true. So how to do it? Okay, so this is a line. Very easy. Same thing, GLM, general linear model. Smoker is a wire response. You want to test if the patient, if the participant is a smoker or not. There are one, binary. Age is continuous. Okay? Then family is binomial. You run this line. You run this code. Binomial means it's a logistic regression. To tell the computer it's a logistic regression. Family means this. Like generalized formula, generalized linear model can have multiple families. It can be binomial family, can be Gaussian family, can be Poisson family. So you can have a different type. Later I will teach you this, but this I will just briefly talk. But now you only need to know logistic regression is binomial because yes or no, one or zero. Okay? So you run this, then you store it into a logic rack too. This is any form variable name you give it. You run a summary. Anything, when you get a value, when you get a result, first thing first, what you need to look at? P, okay? Look at P first. Is it significant? No, it's not significant. So what does it say?
No
association, okay? There is no association between age and smoker status. So in that sense, in another word is, age does not determine if you're a smoker or not. Okay, makes sense, right? Okay, so statistically, it says so as well. Okay, so here, I do the same thing. P is greater than 0.05, not significant. Our conclusion is, since P is greater than 0.05, H is not a significant predictor for smoker status. All right, next. Binary Y and categorical X. Binary Y, we still use smoker as an example. Categorical Y, a categorical X. Who is a categorical? Race, right, in my data set. Race is categorical. Then we use a factor. Still remember, we cannot just put a race here. If we just put race here, the computer will take 1 to 4 as numbers. Okay, they are individual numeric numbers. You use a factor to tell the computer race 1, 2, 3, 4 are categorical. Okay, now this 1, 2, 3, 4 are non-numeric, they are category. Okay, then you run this line. First thing first, what do you look at? P, correct? You don't have to read the number, you just look at the star. The more star, the more significant. Okay, 3 star means definitely significant. Okay, so all of them are significant predictors. So race is a significant predictor for smoker status. But how to interpret? Look, you do not have one here, right? You have only 2, 3, 4. Because this is logistic regression, you have to have a baseline. You have to have a base to compare with. So this 2, you have this estimate, right, 1.68. This number actually compare with risk 1. So your risk 1 is a baseline. So you want to you have this estimate. This estimate actually is a P. You want to compare with the risk 1. So that actually this risk 2 is Malay. This number tells you the odds comparing Malay versus Chinese. Then this one is a 3 is an Indian. This number tells you the odds ratio comparing Indian versus Chinese. The first one is always a baseline. Okay? This one is other status, which is the AMOS. Okay? Then they will have this odds compared with Chinese. Can you use this number as odds? No. You have to do exponential. Okay, so you do exponential of all this tree. How? You just do exponential. You get all these numbers. These are the odd numbers comparing Malay with Chinese, Indian with Chinese, Amos with Chinese. How to interpret the number? This 5.3 means the probability of you being a Malay, the probability of you being a smoker and at the same time you are Malay are 5 times compared to the Chinese. Can get what I'm saying? Chinese is the baseline. Okay? So whatever value you get here is a ratio. And the ratio means you want to compare something with something. The with something is a Chinese. So this result essentially says race is a significant predictor for smoker status. And in this data set, Malay are 5 times more smoker than Chinese. So that means if you're Malay, you have 5 times more probability being a smoker than a Chinese being a smoker. So that means Malays like to smoke in that sense. And how likely they are 5 times more than Chinese. So in the data set, if you go to the data set yourself, you probably will end up with you dig up with all the smoke status and dig up all the races, you try to tabulate them. Okay, this is, you tabulate them, you get how many Malay they are smoking, how many Chinese they are smoking, the number will be about 5 times. But by tabulating it very troublesome, do a linear regression will tell you. Okay, and similarly, if you are Indian, you are about 3 times more likely to be a smoker than Chinese. In my data set, I'm not saying it's generalized. In my data set, it says so. Okay, Amor also. So in this data set, Chinese are less likely to be a smoker. Okay, then how you interpret data. Ken? The important things about logistic regression is whenever you get your estimate, which is the beta, you have to exponentiate. Then the exponentiate is the odds ratio. And odds ratio, when you say it's a ratio, it must be something compared with something, right? Something against something. The bottom part with something, that thing is a baseline. The baseline is always the first thing in your category, which is the Chinese. Chinese is one, right? If you change it, if you want to represent race one be the Malay, then it will be another way around. But normally you have to define a baseline. And default, the first category in your categorical data is the baseline. Clear? Okay? Interesting result, right? So, now I will do some summary. Regression models. Today we have learned 3 different regression models. Simple linear regression. So the Y response must be continuous. Okay? Continuous means they are numeric and they can take any values. X variables must be a single variable and it can take any type. Binary, category, or continuous. Multilinear regression means when you have more Y, more X, you want to see if the every variable X you want to add into the equation, you have multiple of them. So you use a multiple linear regression. Okay? That means multiple factor rather than one single factor. So these two are essentially the same. This is just an upgrade of this. Then now, previously we only see Y must be continuous. What happens if Y is categorical? If Y is binary. Okay? If Y is binary, then you have to use logistic regression model. Okay? Which model to choose totally depends on the data type. That's why I initially emphasize on data type. You have to recognize your data type first to determine which model to use. And the YX variable can be a single variable or can be a multiple variable. So we do not care about what X is, and I also don't care what X data type is. Okay? Just look at the Y. Y binary or Y is continuous. And the important thing is when you use logistic regression, you get the estimate, you have to remember to exponentiate to get the odds ratio. All right, okay? So generalized linear models, just now we talk about the, you asked about the family because to binomial, right? So when you deal with binary outcome or logistic outcome, okay? In the generalized linear model, which is a GLM function, the family can also equals to Gaussian. Gaussian means, Gaussian means normal. Right, Gaussian distribution, normal distribution. Gauss. You also have the Poisson distribution. You heard Poisson? Poisson means count. Okay, whenever you do count data, for example, number of occurrence, for example, number of disease cases this year, number of cars per minute, number of students in different classroom. Okay, count data, you use Poisson. Okay, so depends on your y variable. If you know your y variable follows a certain distribution, for example, now you want to do a imaginary model. For example, your y variable now become your height. You want to see if gender affects the height. For example, girl or guy, if the gender affects the guy, the height. Intuitively, guys have higher, on average, taller than girls, right? So you want to test. So your x variable will be your guy or girl, right? Your x variable is binary. Your y variable is continuous, correct? Which is the height number. But this way, you do not try to use, because the height does not follow a straight linear line. So you remember, if you want to plot the height, previously all the numbers, when I plot, it generally looks like a straight line, right? All the dots are scatter plot. Generally look at a straight line, but height is very strange. Height follows a normal distribution. In reality, if you want to plot height, people's height, it looks like this. It does not look like this. Okay, if you go up and go down, because you cannot forever grow in height, right? So sometimes you go up, then you go down. So the height follows a normal distribution. You know this prior knowledge. So when you try to fit a model about age, as about the gender and height, you want to fit into a Gaussian distribution. So in that sense, you use GLM. Y is your height, title, your age, comma, family equals to Gaussian. Then you use a Gaussian distribution to fit this model. Okay, this is how you do. If you use you know the prior knowledge of your Y distribution. For example, now another thing, I give you a Y. Y will be the number of cars per minute. Then it will be count data, right? It's another way. It's no longer normally distributed, right? It's Poissonly distributed. Poisson is a count data. You all know, right? So you want to fit, for example, number of car or number of disease cases per month. For example, dengue fever. In Singapore, every month about 100 to 20 dengue fever cases in Singapore. But you want to see across one whole year, 52 months, that's 52 weeks. Each week, how many of them got dengue fever? So you go to the MOH website, you download the weekly case data. So this weekly case data, what kind of distribution is likely to follow? Poisson distribution, because they are count data, right? So you use GLM, Y will be your number of cases per week, title, so we are X variable, probably weather, okay? If you have a bad weather, for example, rain or not. If you rain, probably you have more stagnant water, so you have more mosquitoes, so you have more cases. So you want to test if the weather data cause higher number of dengue cases. So you may want to have this GLM, Y is your number of cases per week. Title will be the weekly rain status, rain or not. Or even if you do not want to use rain or not, as binary, you can also use the exact number of waterfall. Okay, how much precipitation? Okay, in terms of mm, okay, millimeter cube. Okay, then you want to see if higher rainfall cause higher number of people getting the disease, dengue fever. Then what the family use? since your y is a count data, you know prior knowledge, it should follow a Poisson distribution. Then your comma family equals to Poisson. Okay? So these are different type. So I give an example here, Gaussian linear regression, that means if you already know your y definitely follow a normal, what are the things follow normal distribution? Most of the things in nature. For example, height, weight, for example, what else? Test score. Okay? Test score also follow a normal distribution. So all these things you know, then it's called prior knowledge, then you can choose in your GLM the family equals to. Now we use family equals to binomial because y follows are binary, right? If y follows normal, then you use y family equals to Gaussian. If you know your y follows a Poisson, then you use family equals to Poisson. Okay, you can get all these little minor details go online. Or I also send you upload a document. What are the different type or different extra argument in your in choosing your model? Okay. Then the model will not capture the data. Because when you do a model, you want to use a model to try to fit your data. So the data will definitely follow some distribution, for sure. Because if you have more data, it either follows a linear relationship, that means forever increasing. For when x increases, y also increases. So when you scatter plot them, they will like always dot a linear line. So a linear line is a linear regression model. Okay? But sometimes for example, height, it does not forever increasing. Okay? If you go up, then go down. So when you plot them, the scatter plot, it will look at something like this. So you know the height definitely follows a normal distribution, then you choose your GLM BR Gaussian distribution. So you choose a model to fit the data.
But if you use the wrong
one? If you choose the wrong one, then you will get some result, but the result is not valid. How do I know if it's valid? For example, if your wave response is binary, you definitely cannot use a normal distribution to fit it, because it will return you result. It will return you error because your y is not continuous. So if you use the wrong one, sometimes the system will prompt you saying wrong, but sometimes the system does not give you the hint. For example, if you try to really fit a normal distribution to a Poisson count data, Ken, do you remember in JC statistics you learned sometimes Poisson distribution can be fitted as a normal distribution when your mean greater than 50. Do you remember that? Poisson distribution, the argument is a mean, right? Poisson, PO, bracket, mean, theta. The normal distribution is an N normal, bracket, mean, comma, standard deviation, right? So you still remember your JC stuff? Right, so sometimes these two distributions can be approximately equal when you have certain condition met. Okay? If your sample size big enough, normal distribution is akin. Okay? LM is linear model. Linear model only deal with straight line. Okay? GLM is generalized linear model. So you can have binomial, linear, Gaussian, Poisson. GLM is superior over LM. You can always use GLM. But the default, without specifying if you do not have a comma family equals to something, the default is Gaussian. Gaussian, yes. So if you just want to do a linear regression model without all this normal Poisson, you use LM. Okay? GLM default, without writing the family equals to, is Gaussian. Family equals to Poisson. Yeah. You do not write the family equals to something, it's default, it's a Gaussian. You write the family equals to binomial, then it's logistic.
That's why you
find your variance. No, you don't have. You don't have to. Okay, we spent 1 hour talk about the regression model already. Everyone clear about what regression model can do? So regression model in sense, it tells you two data sets, their correlation or their association. Okay, you want to see if one column of data correlated with another line of data, and you want to find the coefficient. You want to find how they are correlated. For linear regression, you can tell by a y equals to ax plus b. You can just based on the first one, you give any value, you can predict the next one based on your equation you obtained. This is linear. Later, I also tell you a logistic. Logistic is different because your y variable is binary. You cannot use linear regression because it only has two outcomes, 0 or 1. So you have to do a transformation by using the log p divided by 1 minus p, which is a log odds ratio. So odds ratio tells you something about the p divided by 1 minus p. So it's a compare this with this. So you have the baseline. That's why just now I teach you how to interpret. When you interpret the data, is what is the probability of getting this compared to the baseline. So that's why I analyze the data. I say the Malays has higher rate, has higher probability, which how much higher? 5 times higher than Chinese to be a smoker. Okay? The baseline can be changed. It's troublesome. I don't want to confuse you. But by default, the first category is the baseline, which is the category 1 is your baseline, or the first thing appeared in your data set. Yes, you can also change the baseline to be a Malay, for example. Then the outcome data, the outcome, then your X will be, then your risk 2 will be the Chinese, for example. Then the outcome ratio will be 0.2. Right, because Malay is 5 times more, so the Chinese will be 0.2 more. So they are, it's actually correspondent. Okay? All right, linear regression, very, very simple idea, but it's very powerful method in statistics. And you are very easy to perform, 2 lines of code. Now it comes to visualization. So I just now I said, R is not only very powerful on statistics, it is very, very powerful on making beautiful figures. Okay? By beautiful, I really mean beautiful. Okay. So now I will teach you some default functions embedded in R, then built-in functions to plot. Normal way to plot. Just give you a sense what R can perform. Another one, advanced packages to plot. I didn't introduce my codes in the advanced packages. I just tell you there are packages available for you to plot much nicer figures. And this takes a longer to learn because it's code. So for example, in R, when you want to draw something, in my, I use grid, a package called grid. I draw, for example, I want to draw a square, okay? I don't tell the computer to draw a square. I tell the computer to draw 4 lines. I specify the 4 lines. If this line start from 0, 0, end at 0, 1. This line start at 0, 0, end at 0, -1. I draw 4 lines to plot the figure. So this is more user-friendly, user-customizable, but it's not user-friendly. Okay? Okay, so these are some figures I plot in my research papers. So you can have a rough look what R can, the type of figures R can plot. Can see, right? So it can plot this kind of bars, lines. This is axis. It can also plot this box plot to show the maximum number, minimum number. It'll also show the outliers. It can also draw this curved lines, dispersion of points, scatter plot of points. It can also draw this ROC curve. ROC curve you heard before? Curve under the, okay, never mind. ROC curve is a way to test if your linear regression model is significant or not. It's an added test after you do linear regression. Then this is when I intersect a staggered bar plot. So you have 3 different categories, you stagger them together. Look nice, right? So this is what R can draw. So it's much, in my opinion, much nicer than when you draw in Excel. Right? Because of all the colors you can specify. Okay? So these are just preview, but this is more, this using more advanced R packages. I will teach you the basic one that just for visualization, but more advanced if you want to learn, I can give you the link. Okay, so default functions. These are the default functions for R. For example, plot. Let's do it real time. Plot. When you write plot, what plot can do? Still remember your what are the things you want to plot? For example, here, I give you some example, cars. Okay? I have this vector stored in car, you run it. Then you have this trucks. You also run it. So you have cars, it will return all this. Do you remember this is a vector, right? Last session. Use C concatenate to introduce vector. Cars, trucks. Okay, so you want to see the, you want to plot them, the cars. You just press plot. I will tell you what are the individual things here. So this is a figure using plot. It will generally automatically appearing in the right hand side of the panel. The horizontal line will be the indexes, so you have 5 index, right? You have 5 number. Vertical will be the number, how many cars, okay? So, plot cars, so you can just look at here. So this is a variable you want to plot, comma, type is small o. Okay, small o means? Small o means the dots you want to draw is a circle, okay? So you see the circle, it's a circle, it's not a solid dot. You can change the type later. I will show you what are different type of dots you want to. You can also draw a triangle. You can also draw a square. You can also draw a Mickey Mouse, for example, if you install that. Then color. COL means color. Okay? It can be a blue. Okay? You can specify a name. You can also change it into red. Then it becomes red. Okay? The color does not only mean you can only choose red, blue, black, or something. In R, you have the very, very big power to change whatever color you want. For example, the color has, if you want to change it into steel blue, right? It has many colors. I have a list of them, about a few hundred or thousands of the colors. You can just choose the color you want. Okay? Y-lim. Y-lim means Y-limit. Okay? Y-limit means 0, 12. What does it mean? Yes, you define the Y-axis from 0 to 12. Okay? You limit it. This is, you can also limit your X-axis, but since X-axis doesn't matter, it's an index. So this is how you plot, using a basic plot number. Using a basic plot equation. Then next, you also have your trucks, right? You already plot this. Plot will give you a panel, for example, like this, with a grid, with the x-axis and y-axis. Now you want to introduce the trucks in on top of the cars. How? Then now you do not use the plot again, you use lines. You want to draw lines, right? If you use another plot, if you superimpose this, if you cover this, a new plot. But if you want to introduce lines on top of this plot, you use lines. Okay, lines, for example. Here, what does it say? Type, still small o, that means this is circle. Okay, and not solid. PCH, what does it mean? PCH means point characteristic. Okay, point characteristic equals to 22. I have a reference to for you to change. 22 means square. Okay? You have this, okay, this is when the software developer, they design it. So it's stored inside, it's built-in function. So PCH means point characteristic equals 22 means this is a square. Okay, LTY means line type. Okay, this is a short form for line type. You could do two is dashed line. One is solid line, two is dashed line. You can just change it manually. Color, you already see red, or you want to change it into purple as well. Now, become purple. Whatever color you want. So, go to my slide. This is a PCH. Okay? So, you can choose. See, just now, 22, right? 22 is square. You can choose any number you want. You just do the corresponding one, so the point type will be changed accordingly. A line type, LTY, if you change it to 2 is dashed, 3 is a small dot, you can change it as well. Okay, so this is how your user define it. Okay, just correspondingly change the name. Regarding color, just now I said you can use comma, use red, blue, purple, yellow, all this word, right? But sometimes, if you want to be more fancy, you can also define the color by its RGB or hex number. You know RGB, right? Red, green, or blue. So it's a composition, any color is a composition of three element color. So you can define RGB equals to 0, 0, 1, 0, 1, 0, I think is white, yeah. Then you can also use a hexagon number. Some colors are represented by this hexagon number. Okay, so it's represented by a shark with some hexagon number representation. So for example, you want to go to my Google Drive, R-chart. So these are all the different R colors. You can see the gray, different gray colors. This is how the R can have different colors. You can choose whatever one you want. Now it comes with a name. Okay, so you can use, for example, coral color one. You can use coral. So you have a multiple, a variety of colors for you to choose. Okay, so this is specified by the name, comma. This is specified by hex number. This is specified by RGB. You can use different way to specify the color. Y limit. Yeah, so you specify the Y come from 0. Now I put a 0 to 12, right? You can change it to minus 2 to 12, then you see what's happened. You try. You can change. You can just play with all the different code. For example, here, I change it into minus 10. See the effect? Your Y axis will change from minus 10 to 10, 12. So this is how you change your Y limit. But normally we change. See, this is how you change your Y. Okay, colors, black. Okay, type, big O. Oops. Type, so one is circle. Without the type O, that means it's solid. Okay? Can see? So these are different ways of playing with it. So you can also change the 23, 20. Okay. This is a point characteristic equals to 22, right? You want to make it a triangle. So it's 2. Then you just change it to 2, so it's triangle. Okay? You can just, this is very user-friendly and customizable. Then you want to add a title to it, to your figure. Okay, so your mean is when you define your title. Okay, the mean rate, it means column, when what color you want your title to be. Font size means font size 4. Okay? But here, you want to output this figure, right? This figure appear at right-hand side of the panel. You want to output this figure. How to output? You have two ways to output. One way, go to your figure, export, save as image, save as PDF. Okay? But this way of output figure is not, the resolution is not good. The resolution may be very low. Okay? So you want to make your resolution to be. You want to save this figure, and you also want the resolution to be set. How? You go to here. You can use this line of commands I predefined. PNG with an output file called PNG. Figure.png means the output file name. Okay, you give a name. Height, width, you can define yourself. You want your figure output to be 10 by 10 cm. Unit is cm. Resolution is 1,000. Point size is 10. And that means all this one you can define yourself. Then depth of, that means you open the file, you close the file. Okay? So you can just put all this thing. You put your figures, command, in between of these two lines. Then you run all of them. It will generate a figure and output into the directory you are working with. Okay, it's done. So you go to your desktop. Here. See? It will be output here. And the resolution will be much better. Can you see? When I zoom. Correct. So this is how you output your figure. You can define the figure resolution yourself. For the color, I say the color chart. Another website is called Color Brewer 2. Color Brewer 2 is very, very useful website. This Color Brewer website will give you a combination of colors where when you make your figure, for example, you want to make a bar chart, or you want to make a pie chart, then you want to make the color look nice. Normally, you write red, green, blue, the default color will look very ugly. Okay, so you want to make sure you choose a set of color, they are compatible, and they look nice. So you can choose a color here. For example, you want to find a sequential color, that means from lightest to the darkest. You can also choose a divergent color. That means the five color, you want to, for example, you want the class to be, you want six different colors. Then you also want the color to be divergent. So you can choose the color scheme you want. So you see these five colors, when they put up together, looks very nice, and they are compatible. You can also make sure you want to know if the reader is colorblind, it prints safe, it's a print-friendly photo safe. So that means this four color scheme will be colorblind safe and print friendly. So that means if you print in black and gray, this four color can still be differentiated. Okay? So whenever you have these four colors, you see the four colors, each hexagon values are here. You can also write the RGB values. So all these values you can just copy when you plot your figures. Okay? For example, hexagon color, I want this blue. Okay? So when you plot, see? The light blue here. Okay? Can? So advanced packages. So advanced packages include those pack. You need to install some library. So I said in the first session, R is very extensible. So a lot of the packages available online, you can just download them for your specific use. So in R, there are some good graphic packages. For example, ggplot2 are great. How do you install this library? You need to go to here, packages, plot, packages. Then you press install. So whatever package you want, for example, grid, Okay? Then I try to install. It says it's not available. Because it's already done, it's already downloaded here. Okay? I already have the grid package. So if you do not have, you may want to install that ggplot. Then you press install. It will download the package for you. Then next time you see your ggplot is here. When you want to use it, you put a tick here. Then when you want to plot, then you just put a library bracket ggplot. Because whenever you want to use a specific library or packages, you have to use this called library. You use this library, just like C, you use include certain packages. Okay, so the R is the same. So now let's do some plot. For example, you use this plot tricks. You try to install this. Can any of you install this? This one. Normally you do not have it by default. You have to install it. Go to your packages, install. You type the name. Then you press install. Okay, so now we try to plot some pie graph. For example, we use slices. So we design, these are the different slices. It's a vector, right? How many elements? 5. Okay, you have 5 vectors, and each of them, you have another vector, it's called label. It's a, this is a character array, right? It's a character vector. Okay, it's a country name. Then you plot pi. You want to plot a pi figure. Pi slices. So slices is the things you want to plot, right? It's based on the number. Label will be the labels will be the label, right? The names. You just define as a character array. The mean will be the mean will be the figure title. So you press this, it will look at this. Right, looks nice, right? The default color also looks quite nice, but you can also change the color you want. You are also plotted in 3D. You just need a pi 3D. Okay, the default color you can change. How to change? Do this. Okay, still remember? You can use this to change. You can specify the color, just add extra argument. Okay, the order of the argument does not matter. For example, you can write your color to be here. Doesn't matter. The order does not matter. As long as you specify the, this is a keyword. This is the argument name you want to specify. All right? Now we can also do another scatter plot. Attach empty cars. So what's this attach empty cars? Empty cars is a default data set preloaded with this R. So you just, because some people just want to do a test, so you do not have a test data set. So just this R function, this R language has this preloaded data type for you to load, for you to try an error. So just attach this empty car. So if you have something inside, then you use this library scatter 3D plot, plot 3D. Okay, you can, these are all different libraries you may want to use. If it's not in your packages, you try to install it. Scatter 3D plot. Okay, install. Okay. Okay. So it's here. Then you press tick. Then you want to scatter plot. Attach scatter plot. So this is what does it say? WT is the weight of all this empty card. Looks like this. So it's all the different car names, Mercedes, Mazidas, all the different things. So it's a lot of data. So weight. The weight will be the, okay, those, I don't want to explain this, but you see, this is 3D. Actually, what are the 3D things? Weight will be the MD car, is the car itself, which is a indexes. Dispersion with this one is dispersion. MPG is a MPG here. So actually, you have three-dimensional data. You have three things you want to plot. At the same time, you have to do it in 3D. Okay? So this 3D scatter 3D plot will give you the 3D. PCH, so you remember point characteristic? PCH equals 16 is a solid circle. Highlight 3D, all this small stuff you can just find help R. So it will tell you about what that argument it supports. Type H, H means you have to draw a vertical line. Then you give a name, 3D scatter plot. So the 3D plot looks like this. Looks nice, right? You can specify a color there. You can, for example, color. Okay, you specify into, you have five of them, right? So you can want to red, blue. For color, you have to make sure it's character. Okay. Sure. You can just change it into this way. You just copy the hex.
I don't put it inside the pie.
Huh? You only have one color. I'm demonstrating your five, right? The pie color, right? For example, I see. Can see? Correspondingly, you have all your colors right here. So you want to define a color. Color must be a character defined, right? So you can define the color outside. You can also write this whole string inside here. But my preference is you write it outside. Then you call this color here. So color equals to color. So call equals to color. Then this color, how you define them, is here. Okay, it is a characterized, it's character vector, and each of them is specified by value or name. You can also write your name. For example, you can also write, for example, qualitative, okay, sequential. For example, like this orange. You just copy the hex value, put it here. Okay, five colors together. You run it, see, this orange is changed. This is how you define the colors. But you have to make sure these are corresponding. So this one refers to US, so they are corresponding. The order are corresponding. Okay? You want to make this five color very nice, then you go to here. For example, you want to choose divergent. Divergent color, okay, they look nice, right? Five of them. Divergent. This one looks nice, right? This five color combination. So you can just copy. This is a hexagon value. It's the same usage as you use a name. See, you have the five colors. It looks, these five colors are more compatible with each other. So you can choose the color yourself. The Color Brewer, that website is very good website for you to choose color, because they give you this color combination, which they look nice when they put together. All right. Then what also you can do is like this way. What can you do? Like this kind of figures. So this is R naught means these are R using a normal distribution. So R naught 1000, that means you give a 1000 number, then this 1000 number will follow a normal distribution. Default, there are 1. Okay? So R naught, for example, you write R. Do you remember sample? Last session 1? Correct. We use sample 100, 10. If you sample 10 values randomly from a sequence from 0 to 100. But if you want to sample a distribution, how to sample a distribution? You can use R norm. For example, R norm. R norm means R, normal distribution, 1000 of them, 0, 1. 0,1 means still remember normal distribution has the mean and variance, mean and standard deviation, right? Right? Basic R, basic statistics. If you know this, normal distribution have 2 parameters. One is the standard. One is mean. One is normal. One is standard deviation. So you specify this. If you generate a data which follow normal distribution, how? For example, you put it into A, you want to plot them. Histogram. Okay? Histogram means what? Histogram means you draw all the bars, right? Histogram. So A follows a normal distribution. Yes, it's true. I sampled 1,000 points, and when I want to draw a histogram, it really looks like a normal distribution. And how many of the bricks you want? Now it has about 10 bricks. You want more? Sure. Bricks equal to 20. Where? Okay, I think 20 is the default, the most. So you have 5 bricks, looks like this. You have 10 bricks, look at this. The more bricks you have, the more normal distribution curve it looks like. Okay? This is how you visualize it. Default, you do not have to do. All right? So this essentially gives you a normal distribution of 0 and 1. So default, 0 and 1, it doesn't say. It does not specify. But by right, if you write, you should write this way. So if you generate 2 normal distribution, x and y, it will also write to a hex bin. Hex bin means it want to draw a hexagon. And in a data set, it will just plot this. What does it mean? That means all the random dots superimposed to each other. At certain points are 7 of them superimposed, or 6 of them superimposed. So this is just basic functions R can do. So you can explore all these different ways of drawing figures. Oh, that means you have how many points now? A lot of points, right? But that means 50 points will consider as 1. Okay, so if you have 50 superimposed, but this one you do not bother. This is just some fancy figures. You normally most of the time you won't use it. Yeah. Okay. So now you go to your workbin. I uppload this ggplot too. Ggplot is just now I said it's a more advanced packages. You can just follow the argument, what kind of figures you want to plot. So you can just roughly have. Although if you want to put this kind of figure, what are the things you need to do? You need to put what are the input data, what are the arguments. So ggplot this figure will tell you a lot of things. So bar plot. Trend plot, circle plot, many different heap. Then this is a heap map. Different things you want to plot. So this ggplot cheat sheet will tell you all the arguments you need. Okay? So you can just follow this. This is more advanced plot. Previously, I just teach you all those basic. You just will visualize your data. What else? Okay, recap. So in section one, what I teach you is the basic syntax of R and how you deal with the data. That means when you are given data in the form of CSV, what can you do first to load the data, how you extract the data, and how you export the data. So in section one, I teach you all this. In section two, I teach you how to do basic statistical modeling, which is a regression model. Regression model tell you the association between two vectors or two different variables. You want to find the association. There are three ways, and also you need to know, depending on the outcome, the Y variable, you choose a specific model. Then also tell you about visualization in R. R can plot beautiful figures. So still remember, if you want to plot figures using Excel, you have to specify you have to manually select where to put your legend, where is the legend, the size. You have to do all this troublesome stuff, right? But in R, it gives you very beautiful figures straight away. Okay? It can give you data from your CSV file and directly output figures. And output figures, you can show them on your panel here. You can also output them by using this line, by using this figure out this line and this line. You put your job figure code in between. It will automatically create a figure for you, and it will be very of good size and good resolution. Okay? And that's all for today. Thank you. So we have 15 more minutes. You can ask questions, or you are free to talk.
Yes. Have to put a concatenation in front and
yes.
Find my color.
Yes.
So by right, this should run out a plot of a chart with all the colors that
yes.
I chose.
Yes.
But it's not happening. It's running, but I installed my package tree.
Hey, what happened to your console?
Question. Yep. That was what I was trying to do.
Do you have your H? Yes, you have. It should be appearing here.
Yeah.
Close it and open again. I will try to close it and open again.
So this is drawn by these two lines.
Oh, I see.
so the, your favorite still be, so in between of the PNG and that off is the thing you want to talk to. So plot cards is the thing you want to talk to. So this favorite will be saved in your directory. Where's the directory? Where's the directory? Where's the directory? That means your...
So I put my email address there. If you have any question, you can write me emails.
Yeah.